Any endoscopic sinus surgery procedure, we need to have a, ideally, we need to have a three-dimensional multiplanar like coronal, axial and sagittal, fine section, thin slices CT scan to have a full orientation of the three-dimensional anatomy. But at least we should have a coronal scan, because what we see endoscopically is in the same plane where the coronal scan shows. So this first picture, I am going from front to back. This first picture shows, can you see here?
Yes, very well.
Do you see my cursor moving?
Yes, we can see.
So in the first picture, here is the frontal bone.
Yes.
And below here are the nasal bones.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
This is the nasal septal cartilage and the ala lower down. Now if we move further, this is again the same structures. This is roughly 1 mm CT scans, 1 mm slices. So now
0.75.
Now do you see some cavities appearing in the frontal bone like this?
Yes.
This is the pneumatization. So the first pneumatization or this cells is the real frontal sinus. The anterior most picture shows the frontal sinuses.
Yes.
And here we see the left side prominent frontal sinus, and in the middle this looks like interfrontal sinus cell. On the left side it is not pneumatized.
Right.
On the right side it is not pneumatized.
Yeah.
And again here the nasal bones meeting in the midline here.
Yeah.
And the same the septum and the ala down. Now when we move further forward, the same structures, structures. Now see the pneumatization of the right side of the frontal bone coming into the picture.
Yeah.
The right frontal sinus, it is not as big as the left frontal sinus, so it is not pneumatized.
Yeah.
Not very pneumatized. Now see, why I'm calling this as a frontal sinuses?
Yes.
You see the floor.
Yeah.
The floor is formed by the frontal bone that ultimately formed shown as a beak. We'll see later.
Yeah.
So as long as the floor is intact, this is proper frontal sinuses.
Okay.
Left side interfrontal sinus cell looks like interfrontal sinus cell. You are not sure unless we see the opening. It opens in either of the frontal sinus, right or left.
Yeah.
Okay. Then only it is confirmed.
Yeah.
Now moving further down.
Yeah.
Now what we see here is the frontonasal process.
Yeah.
Of the, this is formed by this is frontonasal process of the maxillary bone and the frontal bone. You can say.
Yeah.
So both these processes form this frontonasal process. Now moving further down, still the floor is intact.
Yes.
Yeah. Appreciate
so, as long as the floor is intact,
this
is frontal sinus.
Still frontal,
Frontal T, you can say. This kind of a picture known as some people call it as frontal T.
Yeah.
Still the floor is in. Now you see.
Yes.
The transition. I'll go back and show. This was the interfrontal sinus cell.
Yes.
This is the partition. And in the next slice, you see it is opening on the left side.
Yes.
So left is more pneumatized, and this interfrontal sinus cell, now it is confirmed as interfrontal sinus cell as it is opening into the left frontal sinus.
Yes.
Now see the first pneumatization appearing.
The first cell,
The cell, first cell appearing down in the vicinity of this frontonasal process.
Yes.
This is the Agar-Naji cell.
Yeah.
If you go further behind, you see the well-developed Agar-Naji cells.
Yes.
And yet we don't see the maxillary sinuses as such.
Yes.
So this is the anterior picture. And anteriorly we see the frontonasal process, and here is the Agar-Naji cell.
Yeah.
Agar-Naji is basically the pneumatization of the lacrimal bone, which lies anteriorly. So here do we see the Agar-Naji cells in relation to the lacrimal bone. See,
it
now
started coming up
in the next picture.
Yeah.
Just close to the lacrimal, this Agar-Naji cell is the lacrimal sac, or the beginning of the nasolacrimal duct.
Yes.
The continuation of which below is the nasolacrimal duct.
Yes.
Now, the frontal sinuses coming into the picture.
Maxillary. Yeah. Hmm.
Now we don't see any thick bone in the floor of the frontal sinus, so we call this as a frontal recess. Earlier we saw the thick bone in the floor of the frontal sinus. So those were the frontal sinuses. Now we are moving posteriorly. So this is basically the frontal recesses, both sides.
Okay.
And this part of the recess, see, going above the orbit.
Yeah.
Above the orbit. This is over-pneumatization of this zygomatic process of the orbit.
Okay.
This one.
Mm-hmm.
See, on this side it is not pneumatized.
Yes.
But here it is over-pneumatized.
Yes.
So this is a supra-orbital cell.
Okay.
Now, how to identify it? See, earlier, I am going back. These are the frontal sinuses.
Yes.
But we don't see any maxillary sinus below.
Yes.
Now the same cells like this.
Uh-huh.
You see the supraorbital recess, okay, looking like frontal sinus.
Okay.
But we see the maxillary sinus appearing below.
Uh-huh.
So when you see this pneumatization with the maxillary sinuses in picture,
plane. Okay.
With the maxillary sinuses in picture,
yeah,
then it is surely not the frontal sinus. This, yes, is the supraorbital recess.
Yeah. Okay.
Once you see the frontal sinus, you won't see anywhere the maxillary sinuses in the picture.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, going further back, now the next, there are few structures coming into view. Now, inferiorly, yes, you see the inferior turbinate.
Yes.
See the room, this nasal cavity looks roomy.
Yeah.
Like the picture of atrophic rhinitis. The cells are not, it's not very, this,
yeah,
sinus labyrinth is not very pneumatized,
yeah,
you can say. They are not very,
yeah,
too much of number of cells.
Thank you.
Now, the next structure here is the middle turbinate coming into,
yeah,
the picture.
Yeah.
And see, this is the roof of the anterior ethmoid. See,
yes,
this agar region, all cells now coming into the picture, all these cells belong to the anterior ethmoidal group of cells.
Yeah.
And this is the roof of the anterior ethmoid.
Yeah.
Now, if we move behind further, see the middle turbinate, very clear,
yeah,
well formed. And here it goes up and attaches to the cribriform plate.
Yeah.
Let's see if it is clear on the CT scan. You can see on this side it is pretty clear.
Yeah.
See, this is the cribriform plate here.
Mm.
This is not the cribriform plate.
Yeah.
This is the fovea.
Yeah.
This is the roof of the uppermost ethmoidal cell. See?
Yes. Yes.
See, if we go into the anatomy of these ethmoidal cells, there are number of ethmoidal cells on either side, and this uppermost group of ethmoidal cells is roofed by the frontal bone. So this is the part of the frontal bone roofing the open uppermost ethmoidal cell. So this is known as fovea.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Here is the cribriform plate. It has two parts.
Fovea is the region, right?
It's, yes,
the region, yeah. Not the cell. Yeah.
Not the cell. Mm-hmm. This roof. Roof.
The roof. Yeah.
Mm. Now here.
Yeah.
This is the cribriform plate.
Yeah.
It has two parts: the horizontal and the vertical.
Yeah.
Majority of the time you see both the things very clear. Here, once we go posteriorly, we may see clearly. But here the thing is, this crista galla is it's not pneumatized.
Yeah.
But it is quite
big, yeah,
prominent.
Yeah.
And see, this is the horizontal plate of the cribriform and this is the vertical.
Yeah.
And at this junction of the horizontal and vertical plate is the insertion of the middle turbinate.
Yeah.
So this is the first part of the middle turbinate. Middle turbinate has three parts. We'll see in the dissection.
Yeah.
This is the first part lying in the sagittal plane, goes up and attached to the cribriform plate at the junction of the horizontal and the vertical plate. And this has a clinical significance, as we have to give respect to the middle turbinate rather than forcefully handling it. Otherwise, it may lead to a distant fracture at the level of the cribriform plate and the consequent CSF leak. Okay. Now, going further behind, see, we have seen the agar cells earlier. Now, middle turbinate in picture, and now see this prominent cell on both sides.
Yes.
This looks like bulla ethmoidalis. Bulla ethmoidalis.
Yeah.
Okay. And you see the lower part of the
nasolacrimal
duct is oriented in such a fashion. This lies anteriorly, and this is the lowermost part, and this is the inferior turbinate here.
Yeah.
Now, going behind further, we don't see, looks like the uncinate process. It's
okay.
Not very clear. This
okay.
particular ethmoidal labyrinth is not very pneumatized.
Yeah.
We can't say for sure that this is the uncinate process, but it looks like this projection arising from the inferior turbinate looks like the uncinate process.
Uh-huh.
But let's see behind. So it's not very clear here in the CT scan, but just for the information, here is the attachment of the uncinate process, which goes behind like this, goes up, and this entire region is known as the osteomietal complex area.
Yeah.
This is comprised of the uncinate process, the bulla ethmoidalis, the middle turbinate. Between the uncinate and bulla is the hiatus seminiferus inferioris. Between the bulla and the middle turbinate, hiatus seminiferus superioris, and the infundibulum, into which the maxillary sinus ostium opens. This entire region is osteomietal complex. Why it is important? As dependent sinuses like the maxillary sinus and the frontal sinus through the frontal recess opens into this area, and this area having the narrow channels for the ventilation for these dependent sinuses, ventilation and drainage of these dependent sinuses. If there is some underlying allergy or infection, the resultant mucosal edema can block the ventilation and drainage of these important these dependent sinuses and can lead to sinusitis.
Yeah.
So this is the significance of these narrow channels.
Okay. So okay. Let's go only up to the anterior ethmoidals and then stop and go to the dissection.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, Ashish.
Yeah.
Just quickly now.
Yeah.
So now moving behind, you see now earlier we saw the anterior ethmoidal skull base.
Yes.
Now you see the anterior ethmoidal skull base more clearly.
Yeah.
This is the attachment of the middle turbinate above.
Yeah.
Horizontal cribriform, vertical cribriform. This is the middle turbinate on this side, and now you see the uncinate process very very clear.
Yes.
Okay. This is hiatus seminiferus inferioris. Now going behind, as we have to go quickly through this part. Yeah. At this point, can you see some conical projection from the orbit?
Yeah.
See, in the posterior part of the frontal recess, or in the posterior part of the suprabullar recess, sometimes when the bulla is not going up, this conical projection from the orbit towards the lateral lamella, this houses the anterior ethmoidal artery. We'll see in the cadaver the detailed course of this anterior ethmoidal artery, but this is typically, you can see on the CT scan, and this is typically at the confluence of, this is the medial rectus muscle. Hmm. Can you appreciate?
Yes.
This side?
On the other side better, yeah.
And this is the superior oblique.
Yes.
So this is typically at the junction of confluence of the medial rectus and superior oblique, where this artery exits the orbit. We'll see the complete course in the cadaver. Hmm. Okay, now, see, we saw the middle turbinate, first part. Hello?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yes, now see the second part of the middle. The middle turbinate
turning.
Taking the lateral curvature and going towards the lamina papyracea.
Yes.
So this is known as ground lamella or basal lamella. So all these cells lying anteriorly and inferiorly are the anterior ethmoidal group of cells, and the cells lying behind and superiorly are the posterior ethmoidal group of cells. Okay.
Perfect. Yeah.
Now in place, now see, there are certain changes you can make out on a CT scan. Changing from the anterior to the posterior ethmoid. See, this is the point where the anterior ethmoid is changing to the posterior ethmoid now. And the point is the ground lamella.
Yeah.
Now we are moving behind, and now you see the change.
Yes.
Now there are two different turbinates coming in the place of the, where the middle turbinate was there earlier.
Yes.
These are the superior turbinate. The moment posterior ethmoid starts, the superior turbinate comes into the picture. Okay. Now see, change in the picture. Grossly, I'll tell you, there are five changes you notice when you go from anterior to the posterior ethmoid on a CT scan. The orbit size, I will keep on showing one by one. I'm going behind. See the size of the orbit.
Yes.
Reducing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Number two, the size of the cells.
Yeah.
Look at the size of the cells in the posterior ethmoid.
Yeah.
Increasing in the size.
Yes.
The larger size cells.
Mm.
Number three, the shape of the maxillary sinus. See, once you go behind,
oval,
this globular shape becomes oval.
Oval, yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And see the shape of the roof of the ethmoid.
Yeah. Changing.
Going
flattening
behind,
out.
It is becoming flatter and thicker.
Yeah.
So these are certain changes one may notice on a CT scan while transitioning from anterior to the posterior ethmoid.
Yeah.
Okay?
Very
now
good.
We are in the posterior ethmoid. We see the larger cells. These are basically pyramidal shaped cells. We will see on the cadaver, their tip is directing posteriorly. See, these are the voids, bigger cells, and their tip is behind towards the posterior wall. Now see the middle turbinate here. This is the third part of the middle turbinate now.
Yeah.
We saw the second part attaching towards the lamina papyracea, and this is the third part which is attached to the, this is the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone. Okay. This is perpendicular plate of the palatine bone, and this is the inferior turbinate. Going further behind, we can see here. Can you see over here?
We can see, but I don't know what it is.
This is pterygopalatine fossa.
Okay.
And this is the infraorbital fissure.
Okay. So we are going to see all of this in the dissection.
Yeah, pterygopalatine fossa, infraorbital fissure, and the pterygomaxillary fissure. This is infraorbital fissure. This is pterygomaxillary fissure communicating this pterygopalatine fossa to the infratemporal fossa. This again we'll see on the cadaver. We'll dissect the infratemporal fossa in depth. Okay. Now moving further behind. Now see, this is the sphenoid sinus coming into the picture, and medially here is the ostium of the sphenoid sinus, not very clear. But now see the orbit reducing to the minimum. This is the posterior most part of the orbit, and we call it as orbital apex. Okay?
Yeah.
Now this part of the orbital apex here, medially here, this bone, if we remove this bone, this leads to the orbital apex. And here is the superior orbital fissure which comes superiorly. But whatever structure we see here, some prominences if you notice here.
Yeah.
This is the prominence laterally of the paraclival carotid artery. Carotid has different parts we'll see on the cadaver, and this is one of them, the paraclival course of the carotid. This depression above here is the depression for the optic nerve, and here in between is this pneumatization is the optico-carotic recess, which is basically the pneumatization of the optic strut, which is a part of the anterior clinoid process. Now the important finding in this case here is the lateral extent of the lateral pneumatization of the sphenoid sinus. If you notice here, can you see?
Yes, very
this
well.
Is the lateral recess.
Yeah.
And this is bounded on both sides. You see the prominences. This is the foramen rotundum exiting or housing the V2, the maxillary branch of the trigeminal nerve, and here is the Vedian canal in the floor of the sphenoid sinus. So once this over pneumatization, the lateral recess, this takes place at the expense of the pterygoid process of the sphenoid bone. So this is this over pneumatization, lateral recess is at the expense of the pterygoid process. Sometimes we get the CSF leak, and to repair these leaks, the direct approach is transpterygoid. You go through the pterygoid process, drill it, and you are at the site of the CSF leak. Going further behind, you see the same structures. The sphenoid is well pneumatized. This is a positive sign for the endoscopic surgery. And we go further behind, we see the foramen ovale here, where the or this is a sort of a canal exiting the V3, the mandibular branch. Okay. So we'll see the rest of the things on the cadaver.
Yes, thank you. Good. So let's go to the cadaver now.
So in between, if anybody has any query or wants to relate to the CT scan, the intraoperative finding, please.
We'll come back and forth.
Yeah. So now, can you change to the endoscopic picture, please? Ashish.
Yeah, Satish.
Getting
fantastic. Very, very nice. We are getting the endoscopic picture. Yeah.
How is the picture?
Fantastic.
Fantastic. Superb.
Yeah, absolutely great.
And the cadaver looks superb.
The cadaver is also very nice.
Yeah. Beautiful. I saw when Arvind was preparing. Superb. Again, thanks to the Vandana Joshi and the entire team.
And the FMC people. They made this
and available. The FMC people. Definitely.
Yeah.
Okay. So, before starting any dissection, I would like to take you to the anatomical landmarks which we see on nasal endoscopic finding. Okay?
Yeah.
This is the inferior turbinate.
Yes.
Anterior most. Here is the middle turbinate.
Yes.
And as we saw on the CT scan, this is the first part of the middle turbinate lying in the sagittal plane.
Yes.
So this first part is attached anteriorly here to the frontonasal process. This is the frontonasal process. This first part is attached anteriorly to the frontonasal process and behind superiorly to the cribriform plate. We'll see when we dissect.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, in the middle meatus, see there are certain structures. Ball probe hai? नहीं है, ओके. सो दिस इज द फर्स्ट इंपॉर्टेंट स्ट्रक्चर, इज द फर्स्ट प्रोमिनेंस इज द अनसीनेट प्रोसेस सेक्शन.
या
हेलो
हेलो या या
सो दिस फर्स्ट प्रोमिनेंस इन द लैटरल वॉल सेक्शन बंद है यार, ये बंद है.
Just to interfere for a moment.
Yeah,
at Jaipur, when we attended the workshop, similarly here we are seeing the picture. You feel as if this is live surgery. And at when Satish's workshop, we watched surgeries, it looked as if he is performing on a cadaver.
Thank you.
So on behalf of AOI, I welcome you all here. I am very thankful that you have gathered in such a huge number. There is not going to be any break in Satish's dissection of cadaver. You may take a break once we announce for refreshments.
Bina nicho hai rakh do. Bina nicho. Yes.
And Vandana, what is our outer time? We have to.
We will be working till 7, I suppose.
8?
7, 7.
Let's negotiate 8.
Hello.
Hello.
If you allow Satish, he may operate till, you know, 10 o'clock as well.
Yeah. Okay.
Hello.
Yeah, Satish.
Ashish,
yeah.
Now.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the first prominence in the lateral wall is the uncinate process.
Yes.
Can you see?
Yeah, we can see. Well.
And for the junior guys, whenever there are polyposis or if there is any confusion, this is the only mobile structure in the lateral wall. See, okay. The uncinate process, the mobile uncinate process, no other prominences are mobile in the lateral wall. Okay.
Okay.
Behind is the bulla ethmoidalis. In between here is the hiatus seminalis inferioris, which leads laterally to the infundibulum, into which the maxillary sinus ostium open. We'll see. Now here, this is the bulla and the middle turbinate, and this is the hiatus seminalis superioris. This leads behind to the front, to the retrobulbar recess.
Yeah.
Now this is the first part of the turbinate. And here you see, this is the second part,
yes,
of the turbinate.
Very nice.
Turning laterally towards, yeah, the lamina. This lies in the coronal plane. And here this is the third part of the turbinate lying, going behind in the axial plane. This is the third,
yeah,
part.
Yeah, yeah.
And this goes up to the roof of the nasopharynx and has an attachment with the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone and sometimes to the medial pterygoid plate even.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the middle meatus, and this entire area is known as the osteomeatal complex.
Yeah.
Now going behind, medial to the middle turbinate, see,
dented
another prominence here,
yeah,
this is superior turbinate.
Not, okay, visible, okay, now, well, yeah.
And medial to the superior turbinate, between,
yeah,
the superior turbinate and the
septum,
nasal septum, here you can see the prominent is sphenoidal,
yeah,
ostium.
Yeah.
So this is roughly 1.5 to 2 cm above the roof of the coina.
Yeah.
Now going behind in the coina, we don't have a ball problem, no? Okay. Now see, there are some important findings behind. This is the posterior end of the inferior turbinate.
Yes.
This flat area behind this.
Yeah.
This corresponds to the medial pterygoid plate. Okay.
Okay.
Now this is the eustachian tube orifice.
Yes.
This prominence, the torus tuberi. And behind this is the fossa of Rosenmüller.
Yeah.
See, this fossa and Rosenmüller.
Yeah.
We see with the angle telescope. This tip of this fossa of Rosenmüller extends almost up to the parapharyngeal carotid artery. So this is an important landmark.
Sorry, say it again.
We'll see in the dissection later.
No, say it again. The tip of the fossa of Rosenmüller.
Yeah, extends up to,
yeah,
the parapharyngeal carotid artery.
Okay.
If it is very clear cut, and
you will show
sometimes
it.
Sometimes, yeah, you don't see because of the lymphoid hypertrophy, this,
okay,
fossa very clearly.
Okay. Fine.
We'll correlate, we'll expose the parapharyngeal carotid, we'll try to dissect the all parts of the carotid during the dissection if time permits.
Yeah.
And we'll see. This is an important landmark in carrying out a nasopharyngectomy procedure.
Okay.
This fossa and Rosenmüller and the torus tuberis. This medial pterygoid plate.
Okay.
Now coming back anteriorly, this is the anterior end of the inferior turbinate. If I retract it, see, 1 cm behind the anterior end,
yeah,
superiorly, see here, can you press the, can you see the,
yeah,
Can you see the fluid coming?
Very nice.
That is the wall of Hessner.
Through
which the nasolacrimal duct opens into the inferior turbinate. Is it clear here?
Fantastic. Very nice. Yeah.
So this is 1 centimeter behind the anterior end of the inferior turbinate, and that is known as the apex of the inferior meatus. This is the highest point of the inferior meatus.
Okay.
Known as apex of the inferior meatus. Okay?
Okay.
So will today's plan of action, my focus would be on emphasizing the anatomy of the nasal cavity, paranasal sinuses, and the surrounding areas which are important from our clinical point of view, like the pterygopalatine fossa, the infratemporal fossa, the nasopharynx, and the parapharyngeal space. All the lesions arising in these areas or extending into these areas now can be completely extirpated by this nasal endoscopic approach, and it has become rather the approach of choice to all these lesions through the nasal route. Then moving from there, we'll go on to the skull base and try to see the anatomy of the skull base relevant to the nasal cavity and all those approaches devised to approach the skull base lesions endoscopically.
Okay.
Okay. Now, to begin with, give me the reverse biting. So first of all, endoscopic sinus surgery procedure for the paranasal sinus diseases starts with the uncinectomy.
Yeah.
Okay. There are many ways to accomplish this uncinectomy procedure. This uncinect process typically has two parts. What we see is the vertical part, and here comes, this is the band, and here comes the horizontal part going behind. Can you see?
Yes, very well. Yeah.
This vertical part has variable insertions. Most often it inserts laterally onto the lamina papyracea, and this has a very important clinical correlation. As I said, this inserts most often on the lamina papyracea. The frontal recess outflow or the frontal outflow drainage is medial to the uncinate process.
Yes. Yeah.
In uncommon situations, this may attach medially to the upper part of the middle turbinate or even to the skull base. In that situation, we should know this thing preoperatively by means of a CT scan. In that situation, the frontal outflow is medial to the uncinate attachment.
Lateral, yeah. Mm.
Okay? Mm. So that has an importance, and importance in the other relevance is the injury to the skull base. That should not happen to at this stage of the procedure while doing uncinectomy. So knowing this insertion of the uncinate, upper end of the uncinate process, we can do or accomplish this step safely. Okay?
Yeah.
Now this lower end, this goes posteriorly, sometime even to the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone.
Uh-huh.
There are many ways to remove the uncinate process, but our approach of choice is to use a reverse biting. See, for the junior colleagues, the important thing is always navigate your instrument by means of following with the telescope. See, introduce the instrument first and follow with the telescope. Do you get me?
Yes, very nice.
So take your reverse biting, take to the middle meatus, open it and glide it gently into the hiatus seminalis and direct it inferiorly. Okay?
Yeah.
This is important. If you direct it inferiorly, this makes you a little bit away from the nasolacrimal system. If you direct it superiorly, the nasolacrimal duct is very close. So it is always recommended to direct it inferiorly. Then take a bite. One more. Until you feel the hard bone. Okay?
Yeah.
Hard bone corresponds to the frontonasal duct. So you can go anteriorly by means of 2 or 3 bites until you reach the hard bone. Now, at this point, we have made this window in the uncinate process. Can you see?
Yes, very nicely.
Now, Ashish.
Yeah.
This was the hiatus seminalis inferioris through which we went inside.
Yes. And that
now,
was the
see this three-dimensional space.
That's the infundibulum. Yeah.
This three-dimensional space is the infundibulum.
Yeah.
And this is the maxillary sinus ostium.
Yeah, natural ostium. Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the ostium opens in this three-dimensional space, that is infundibulum.
Yeah.
So infundibulum is bounded medially by this uncinate process. Okay.
Yeah.
And laterally by this the lamina preparatia here.
Mm.
And anteriorly by at the junction of the uncinate process up to its insertion onto the nasolacrimal system.
Yeah.
And laterally the maxillary sinus ostium opens into it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now I am widening the
ostium posterior.
Ostium 40, then a red 40. See, this widening should be done posteriorly. See, we have already reached our anterior limit by means of using the reverse biting.
Yeah.
If we widen it further anteriorly, we may damage the nasolacrimal system.
Yeah.
So widening is always done posteriorly. If you want a mega middle metal enterostomy in cases of tumors or
inverted
massive fungal sinusitis, then this medial wall posteriorly, see this, what I am trying to show.
Yeah.
This medial wall of the maxillary sinus posteriorly here is formed by the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone.
Yeah.
So if you really want to create a mega middle metal enterostomy, just remove this medial wall of the maxillary sinus, remove this perpendicular plate of the palatine bone, and you can widen the maxillary sinus ostium as much as you want. Okay?
Yeah.
Friends, now, please note the PIP there on the left side is for every, all the juniors of course, to see how he is holding the instruments, how he is taking the support with his fingers at vestibule, so that the trauma inside is avoided.
Hello?
Yes, yes.
Now again, Ashish.
Yeah.
Whenever you introduce the micro defibrillator, rather any other instrument, introduce the instrument first and navigate with the telescope.
Yeah.
That is the very important thing for the juniors to get used to from their beginning. Now I am using the red 40 micro defibrillator and removing this horizontal part of the uncinate and creating this maxillary sinus enterostomy or mega middle metal enterostomy. Okay?
Yeah. Perfect. That's important. I think most of us tend to use a 0 degree and then we tend to struggle. So having that angle makes it very easy.
Yeah, this
and he can look at the tip of the defibrillator blade. You know, because it is at an angle, so it, his hand is not coming in the way. So very precisely he can take away millimeter by millimeter what he wants.
Whenever micro defibrillator is to be used, the cutting edge, the tip or the cutting edge should be in proper view. This is a very essential equipment for the endoscopic sinus surgery armamentarium, but has to be used properly, otherwise it can lead to a disaster. Okay, so this is middle meatal enterostomy. Now, to look inside the middle meatus, we need to change to a 70 degree telescope. Okay, you can't see into the maxillary sinus with a 0 degree telescope. Okay, so now we move on to the 70, we change to the 70 degree.
So Satish and all people who follow Satish's technique, we use only 0 and 70. We don't use a 30, we don't use a 45.
Ashish.
Yeah.
Can you see something inside?
I can see something.
See, I am into the maxillary sinus.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is roof.
Roof, yeah.
Can you see some structure running along the roof of the maxillary sinus?
Yes.
These are two structures. One is the infraorbital nerve, which is the continuation of the V2, and another is the infraorbital artery. Can you see?
We can
one
see.
White very and one purple structure
very nicely
running
seen.
Together
yeah.
in the infraorbital canal. See?
Yeah.
Going but towards the anterior wall.
Yes.
By rotating your camera, you can see up to the anterior wall very, very clear. Can you see?
Yes.
So this is how you can see within the maxillary sinus using a 70 degree telescope.
Okay.
So this is the
look
end
at PIP.
Point.
Yeah. Look at PIP as well, the angulation of the scope. I'm just telling the colleagues. Yeah.
Like this. I am not rotating the scope, I am rotating the camera.
Okay.
You just rotate the camera and you can have the look of the entire region of the anterior of maxillary sinus. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, see, this is the end point of the course of the V2. You see this V2, maxillary nerve ending and continuing as infraorbital now. So this is the beginning of the dissection, and hopefully, if time permits, we'll go to the origin of the V2 from the Michael's cave today. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, moving on to the next part. We have removed the lower part of the
uncinate. Yeah.
Now the next step is to remove the upper part of the uncinate process. Now using the 70 degree same. See now, this is the bullet model is?
Yes.
Is it clear?
Yes, very nice.
Middle turbinate?
Yeah.
And so see
the
there
anterior up, wall of the bulla.
This is the upper part of the
uncinate. Yeah.
And it is going laterally, if you see.
Yeah.
Towards the lamina papyracea.
So that does.
Can you
yeah.
see?
Yeah.
And ends as a blind recess.
Yeah.
This is recessus terminalis. So the best way, in my opinion, to remove this upper part of the uncinate is to use a curette or some angle instrument or maybe a ball probe. Go behind the uncinate. See.
Yes.
Go way. Behind the uncinate, just staying anterior superior to the bulla.
Yeah.
Go behind and fracture it from the lateral wall. Can you see?
Very nicely.
The entire length of the uncinate being fractured from the lateral wall. See this?
Yeah.
So this is our preferred technique of removing the uncinate.
So
now this rest of the fractured uncinate can be removed either using a through biting forceps or you can simply debride using a micro debrider.
So this is a wonderful technique because he's teasing it, he's mobilizing that part, then that can easily get sucked because the debrider will only cut what it can suck. So he's making it easy for the debrider in terms of the precision and the efficiency. So the bony fragments are all fractured by the J curette, and whatever is now hanging there, the debrider just takes that away without damaging the lamina papyracea.
Okay. Now, yeah. what yeah. you see here,
yeah.
this cell,
the agar, yeah.
the agar Neji cell, we saw a single agar Neji cell
yeah.
on CT scan, and here I would like to emphasize on certain points,
yeah.
and lot of junior people have a confusion regarding the frontal sinus opening, how to approach the frontal sinus. And Ashish,
yeah.
believe me, I remember 2005 when you were in Jaipur,
yeah.
your presentation on the frontal sinus when
yeah.
Sethi had come.
Yeah.
It is like a box.
Yeah.
It is, believe me, the frontal sinus surgery is as simple or simpler than the maxillary sinus surgery.
Yeah.
Reaching the extreme part of the maxillary sinus is sometimes more difficult than approaching the frontal sinus.
Yeah. Sorry to interrupt, but the key here is that he has done a complete uncinectomy. This is very important.
Yeah, complete uncinectomy.
Because if you have an overhang here, then you tend to get directed more medially and then you make
ball
a mistake.
Probe, yeah.
So this is very, very important to get this tight first.
Ball probe? J-curate. Yes.
Yeah.
So Ashish, so,
yeah.
here,
yeah.
the approaching the frontal sinus, this
yeah.
decision making depends upon the anatomy of the frontal recess.
Yeah.
And frontal recess is not a sort of a duct like nasolacrimal duct.
Yeah.
The anatomy of the frontal recess is governed by the anatomy of the surrounding cells.
Yes.
There are certain cells in the frontal recess lying anteriorly, certain cells lying posteriorly.
Yeah.
And inferiorly here we see the bullet modalis.
Yes, this is the superior
now,
attachment.
They are classified into various groups. The anterior group of cells like agar cells, there can be a single agar cell or can be multiple agar cells. Then the frontal cells. Kuhn cells, Kuhn has described them, frontal cells, these are the ethmoidal cells pneumatizing the frontal bone.
Hmm.
So there are there is a classification of these frontal cells according to their extent into the frontal recess or even the frontal sinus. Like type 1, when is one cell
yeah.
above the agar Neji, type 2, two cells, but all below the level of the beak.
Yeah.
Type 3 is one cell extending beyond the beak into the frontal sinus, but not beyond the 50% of the height. And type 4 is even more than 50% or an isolated cell into the frontal sinus.
Yeah.
So why I have stopped here? We saw only one cell in the CT scan.
Yeah.
That was the agar Neji, and this is the wall. See.
Yeah. Yeah. This is another very important surgical trick to find the cleavage between the middle turbinate and the cell.
Yes.
You will watch Satish going there.
Ashish.
Yeah.
Again, I will
Yeah.
Enumerate your funda of a box.
Correct.
See, this frontal recess sinus area is like a box, and if we limit ourselves to the confines of the box, you are not going to damage any structure outside it. And the limits are, see medially this inferior middle turbinate.
Yeah.
Can you see?
Yes, beautifully, yeah.
If we cross this medial limit, we may injure the skull base.
Yeah.
There are certain fears with the frontal sinus surgery. One of them is entry into the skull base. Second, the lateral limit, that is lamina preparatia. See, it is the lamina preparatia.
Yeah.
If you cross this boundary, you are going to enter the orbit. So these are the two medial and lateral boundaries. If we pass through this gutter between the medial and lateral boundaries, we are not going to injure any of these.
Correct.
And third important point, or the fear a lot of people have, is the anterior ethmoidal artery. See, our bulla ethmoidalis is intact.
Yeah.
You see here. And bulla is going up to the skull base here. So as long as bulla is intact and you are doing skull base work, the bulla covers the anterior ethmoidal artery from anteriorly.
Yeah.
And you never injure the anterior ethmoidal artery if you keep the bulla intact.
Yeah.
Okay. And the fourth important point is the anterior wall.
Yeah.
See, medial, lateral, posteriorly you leave the bulla, and anteriorly this is the frontonasal process. See, housing the nasolacrimal duct. It continues superiorly as a beak, which forms the floor as well as the anterior wall of the frontal sinus. So our anterior limit is the beak, and this is the safest region. There is no critical structure, vital structure in the anterior wall. So if we limit ourselves in this box bounded laterally by the lamina, medially by the middle turbinate, anteriorly by the beak, and posteriorly keeping the bulla intact.
Yeah.
We are going to find the frontal sinus.
Yeah.
So keeping this middle turbinate intact, if we follow this cell, see?
Yeah, bingo.
Go behind the cell.
Yeah.
Go behind and hear the direction of the instrument. See, look at the direction of the instrument.
Yeah.
While working in the frontal recess, the direction of the instrument should always be laterally. Any medially directing forceful movement can lead to damage to the skull base. Okay?
Yeah.
So all instruments should be directed laterally. So I am going behind the cell laterally and fracturing it anteriorly like this.
Yeah.
See? And you are directly into the frontal sinus. See this?
Yeah.
So for the junior
so now colleagues, also show where can we inadvertently damage the skull base. Which stroke can go wrong and where can you damage the skull base? Yeah.
Yes. Number one, if you don't follow the medial limit and start dissecting in this area, obviously you can damage the skull base. Secondly, as I mentioned earlier, in my practice, I never ever look for the search for the frontal sinus first while working in this area. I look for my limits. So I look for my limits, like in this case, I look for my medial limit, lateral limit, the anterior limit is obviously going to be here, and my bulla in view. In between this area, I am sure I cannot damage any other structure.
Okay.
So my message to the junior guys, never ever search for the frontal sinus immediately while you start working in this area, rather look for your limits, don't cross the limits and you will be obviously into the frontal sinus. So now I will remove this fracture cell here and clear this area.
So nowadays we keep talking width before depth. Start clearing wide before you trying to go deep. And I think that is what decoding of exposure is about.
Okay.
Satish, are you still with 70 degrees?
70, yes.
Yes, yes.
He's at 60.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now and see Ashish.
Yeah, beautiful.
Again, the limits.
Yeah.
This is your lamina preparatia laterally.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
This is your middle turbinate flushed medially.
Fantastic.
And this thick bone.
Beak, yeah.
You cannot debride it, you cannot remove it.
You can damage the divider but not the beak.
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is the beak.
Yeah.
And posteriorly, if you keep the bulla intact,
nowhere
you are close to the anterior ethmoidal artery.
Fantastic.
So this is
now, sir, this is the natural ostium, what you are seeing, the bony thing of the frontal.
Pardon?
So the recess is cleared, but what right now circular is staring at us, that is the ostium of the frontal sinus?
Yes, yes, this is the ostium.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
So once you reach this, boundaries.
Yeah. Hello, hello.
Sadi? Yeah.
Sometimes in difficult situation,
yeah.
Peter Walmer suggests axillary flap.
Yeah. See, this origin of the axillary flap developed when there was 70 degree, not in the very common
use, I would say.
Okay. People had difficulties in using the 70 degree earlier,
okay.
And that led to development of this approach.
Okay.
In that situation, you make an incision here,
okay.
Raise this flap and remove this bone, anterior bone.
Okay.
Once you remove this anterior bone, you can access the frontal sinus even with a 30 or 45 degree. Sometimes even with a wide angle 0 degree also.
Okay.
So that unnecessary exposure of this bone, in my opinion, is not required.
Routinely,
if you can
not
use
advisor.
The 70 degree. And not only that, 70 degree gives you the panoramic view of the inside of the frontal sinus. See?
Mm-hmm. That was the
scallopings,
yeah.
Scallopings inside the frontal sinus. And this structure here, this is the posterior table of the frontal sinus.
Yeah.
These are the scallopings inside and this is the beak.
Fantastic.
Sometimes this ostium is not very big,
yeah.
And if you have extensive pathology,
mm.
then you need to remove, you need to enlarge the frontal sinus ostium, okay?
Yeah.
Ashish, I'll show this instrument with the external camera.
Yes, yes.
See my favorite instrument.
Yeah.
See how I engage it.
Yeah.
Can you see the tip?
Very nicely.
You engage it and see this.
Yeah.
So you can, this is the articulated punch from the Karl Storz. This is my man of the match instrument for the frontal sinus.
Yeah. So you can widen the ostium, but you cannot widen the frontal recess.
Frontal recess, not at all.
So the frontal recess is defined by the boundaries.
Yeah.
However, if you need to widen, you may widen the ostium
to
get into.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So I mentioned this point, whenever you need to widen the frontal ostium, where can you widen? See, laterally you have already approached your limit.
Yes.
Medially you have already approached your limit.
Yes. Yeah, so
posteriorly you can't go beyond the posterior table.
Yeah.
Where can you go? Anteriorly.
Only.
See, there is no important structure in the anterior wall. See.
Mm.
If you need to widen the frontal this ostium, you can remove this entire anterior wall. So according to the need, the draft is divided this frontal sinus approaches into three categories. What we have done is draft type 1, the frontal sinus osteotomy. Okay? This is draft type 1. Now if you want to enlarge it further, you just raise this anterior wall flap like this. Okay?
Yeah.
Raise this mucosal flap and drill this anterior wall completely up to the skin.
Yeah.
Drill this anterior wall completely up to the skin. Then it is draft type 2A. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, if you still want to enlarge it, this is the floor of the frontal sinus anteriorly. Then drill this floor of the frontal sinus along with the anterior wall. Then it is draft type 2B. Okay?
Sticking to the same side.
Same side.
Yeah.
If you do this draft type 2B on both sides and remove this upper part of the nasal septum along with the intersinus septum, that is draft 3 or modified endoscopic Lothrops.
Okay.
Is it clear to everyone?
Yes.
Now.
Maybe you want to go over it one more time. Yeah.
Okay. I'll go once more. Give me that my... Arey, wo apna laya tha na cottles. Kidhar rakha? Ashish.
Yeah.
To make it more clearer.
Yeah.
I will show how to do it. Not, I'm not drilling right now.
Yeah.
Just to show the approach.
Approach, yes. Good.
See, this is the anterior wall.
Yes.
Just make a mucosal incision like this. Okay?
Okay.
See, raise this mucosal flap. I'm right now using the Cottle's elevator.
Mm-hmm.
See this mucosal flap?
Yeah.
Like this. Like this. Completely.
Yeah.
See the anterior wall of the frontal sinus now.
Very nice. Yeah.
That is the floor of the frontal sinus.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Here I'll stop first. Give me the scissors, please. Any scissors. So if you remove this anterior wall on one side, that is draft type 2A.
So now you Yeah, so you drill the bone up to the skin. You just go on drilling all of there.
Yeah, the limits anteriorly and laterally are the skin.
Skin. Okay.
Both sides.
Yeah.
See, if you drill this, the orbit is here.
Yeah.
If you drill this here laterally, you have to go up to the skin.
Skin. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. I'll show on one side at least. Now this is the floor.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what is your posterior limit? Posterior to the frontal sinus, we know, is the beginning of the cribriform plate. So we need to define before this drilling, if you are doing a draft type 2A, type 3, we need to define the beginning of the cribriform plate. We are not supposed to go beyond that posteriorly. So the simplest way is, see, I am raising this flap from the floor.
Yeah.
I'll see the beginning of the cribriform plate by finding the first olfactory neuron.
Yeah.
So keep on removing behind, keep on removing behind using the Cottle's elevator. See this?
Yeah.
Can you see some neuron coming out
of the very nicely.
Coming out of the cranial cavity?
Fantastic.
So this is the first olfactory neuron.
Yeah.
So
this is where the drilling should stop. That's the posterior limit.
This is where the cribriform plate starts. And anterior to this, this entire floor anterior wall, you are free to drill it any which way you want.
Okay.
There is no important structure in this region.
Yeah.
So before doing this draft type 2A, type 3, it is best to define the posterior limit by seeing this first olfactory neuron and remove everything and
get
into it.
Satish, sorry to interrupt. Can you orient us with that olfactory neuron with the frontal? Can you just put it in the frontal recess, your endoscope?
Okay.
Yeah.
Here.
Okay. Okay.
Here it is.
Yes. Here it is and it's way posterior to that. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks.
Is it clear?
Perfect.
So if I deposit it back, I will drill it later.
Later, yeah. Okay.
So if we drill this bone again, if we drill this bone, we will be in the frontal sinus. See the frontal sinus from inside?
Yes, yes. So all of this is going and head on straight you'll be.
Yeah. So this is the, this beak.
Yeah.
This beak forms the floor of the frontal sinus as well as the anterior wall.
Okay.
This thick bone forming the anterior wall and this same thick bone forming the floor. If you remove this floor and the anterior wall, the frontal sinus will be exteriorized completely into the nasal cavity. That's what the graph is described and
beautiful.
Classified into type 2A, 2B, 2-3. Okay, clear?
Okay, superb. Please go back to what we do. Yeah.
Okay, so we leave this, replace this mucosa back here.
Yeah.
We'll come back later.
Hello. Ashish.
Yeah.
This is Rohiva.
Ah, yes sir.
We always used to say Sethi is doing Bhangra in frontal sinus.
Yeah.
Now Satish is doing Lungi dance.
Lungi dance, okay.
Okay,
yeah.
So now, as I mentioned in the beginning, that if you use this intact bulla technique, you automatically preserve the anterior ethmoidal artery.
Yeah.
Let's see how this bulla covers the anterior ethmoidal artery and protect it. You see, this is the bulla ethmoidalis.
Now, everybody watch this technique. This is something brilliant.
So, can you see this bulla ethmoidalis?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, very nicely, Satish.
This is bulla.
Yeah.
So my point was this bulla covers the anterior ethmoidal artery.
Yeah.
And if you go by the intact bulla approach to the frontal sinus, your anterior ethmoidal artery is automatically preserved.
Yeah.
Let's see this anatomy, how this bulla protects. So my next step is removal of the bulla.
Yeah.
This again I always do with a 70 degree. See, the best approach is go through the hiatus seminalis superioris in the retrobulbar recess. Can you see the retrobulbar recess?
Yes, very nice.
Go up. See my plane.
This is fantastic.
My instrument is close to the bulla, not towards the skull base.
Yeah.
Go behind the retrobulbar in the retrobulbar recess.
Tip. Show the
and
tip.
Fracture the bulla anteriorly.
Yeah.
See this. My entire bulla is coming one piece.
Yeah.
Can you see?
See guys, this is brilliant. Because and all of this bulla is garbage. Absolute garbage. This is where, fantastic,
okay.
Satish. Yeah.
And this is where your skull base is. Sometimes the anterior ethmoidal artery is very prominent. I don't think it is very prominent in this case.
Yeah.
We'll drill this anterior ethmoidal artery and show you. But this is how the bulla is removed.
So all that we learned, anterior wall, inferior wall, this was bullshit. I mean, just
see
bang.
This?
Yeah.
And another advantage of this technique is mucosa preservation.
Preserving, yes. Absolutely fantastic.
A good outcome in the fest can be achieved not by removing all the polyps, excentrating all the cells, but along with that by preserving the mucosa.
So it's still with a 70 degree scope, please mind it. That is how he can look up there.
See now, this is the lamina laterally.
Very nicely.
Lateral relation of the bulla is the lamina preparatia. This is the lamina below. This is the lamina above in relation to the frontal recess. This is the lamina below. And everywhere you need to keep it mucosalized. And fracturing and removing the bulla by going behind it. See this bulla coming in toto is my preferred approach now. So this way, this is the skull base exposed.
Yes.
So we don't see the entry ethmoidal artery. Majority of the cases we see the entry ethmoidal artery.
Yeah.
But the location of entry ethmoidal artery, in my opinion, would be somewhere here.
So one cell after is what you say, right?
This is going to be the fovea and here is going to be the entry ethmoidal artery. We'll use the diamond bar and show you the entire course of the entry ethmoidal artery.
Yes.
Okay?
Excellent.
So is it clear?
Very nice.
Okay. So now let us move on to the 0 degree to orient what we have done. If anybody has any question, any suggestion, anything to make,
Satish,
any note,
we will reserve the applause to the end.
Hello.
We would like to.
Yeah. Video gone.
You should rewrite the books on approaches, different approaches by Dr. Satish Jain.
Yes. So we are calling the Sinus Summit as the SJT, Satish Jain Techniques.
Yeah. Oh no. Hey, boss, isme nahi aa raha. Bhai, isme nahi aa raha, bhai.
Haan, hamara endoscope picture.
Stores guy. Carl Stores, see, we lost our picture on our monitor. I think it is going there.
No, we are seeing only the external camera.
The monitor is gone. The picture on the monitor is gone. Band karke chalu kar de.
This is very, I think he's developed a very, actually a common sense but hugely talented approach and very time efficient. None of the strokes go waste. He's not playing on some nonsensical part of a disease or this thing, you know, clear, he's got clear these things. Now it's going to be my entry ethmoidal artery, rest all of it is, you'd puncture, yeah. I mean, we used to make a big deal. But the secret is the 70 degree scope and going and just.
Kya hua isme?
Aa raha Satish, we are on.
No, but I am not getting picture on my monitor.
So it's okay, you can do without.
Kya hua isme? Kalsuz wala banda kidhar hai? So meantime, if anybody wants to discuss anything,
only use 0 and 70. That's how you be. No, because you can get away with the 30 or a 45.
Hello.
You resist.
Yeah, Satish.
Yeah, Ashish.
Yeah.
So we take this time to
go back to the CT. If you want to go to the CT while they are getting it.
Yeah, and some anatomy of the entry ethmoidal artery for everyone.
Yeah, you can talk.
Lot of people have doubts and confusion regarding Satish, the course of the entry ethmoidal artery. Yeah.
Okay. Incidentally, the refreshments are ready somewhere outside. So those who wish to step out and whenever.
See, Ashish.
Yeah, Satish.
This anterior and the posterior ethmoidal arteries are basically the branches of the ophthalmic artery.
Yeah.
And which in turn is a branch of internal carotid artery.
Yeah.
So this carries the internal carotid system blood into the nasal cavity.
Yeah.
So this anterior ethmoidal artery is given off as a branch of ophthalmic artery into the orbit. Then it travels.
Folks will be a little bit quiet in the auditorium. Yeah. Satish, go on.
It is given off in the orbit, moves medially and leaves the orbit at the junction of the frontal and the ethmoidal bones. Above is the frontal bone, we know, and below is the ethmoidal bone. It leaves the orbit at the junction of frontal and ethmoidal bone and runs along the roof of the ethmoid in a bony canal.
Yeah.
And then leaves the roof of the ethmoid by piercing the lateral lamella of the cribriform plate.
Yes.
We saw in the CT scan the lateral lamella of the cribriform plate.
Yeah.
So it traverses many compartments. The first compartment was the orbit.
Yes.
Second compartment was the paranasal sinuses, the roof of the ethmoid.
Yeah.
Then it leaves by perforating the lateral lamella of the cribriform into the third compartment, that is olfactory fossa. That is intracranial course of the entry ethmoidal artery. So it enters by perforating the lateral lamina of the cribriform into the olfactory fossa.
Okay.
Then in the olfactory fossa, it runs anteriorly by forming a sulcus on the bone.
Okay.
And there it gives off a branch known as anterior falcine artery.
Anterior?
Falcine, F-A-L-C-I-N-E, falcine
artery.
The fox cerebri attached to the crista gala in the olfactory fossa.
Okay.
So that is the first branch of this antirhythmoidal artery. Then that is the third compartment, the olfactory fossa. Then coming anteriorly in the olfactory fossa, it leaves the fossa and come back in the nasal cavity, in the anterior superior part of the nasal cavity.
Okay.
That is the fourth compartment. The first orbit, second roof of the paranasal sinuses, third is olfactory fossa in the brain, fourth is the anterior superior part of the nasal cavity. Here it supplies the anterior superior part of the nasal cavity, both the medial and the lateral walls.
Okay.
And then it leaves the nasal cavity and come onto the dorsum of the nose underneath the nasal bones.
Okay.
And supply the dorsum of the nose sometimes up to the nasal tip. So that is the fifth compartment.
Wow.
So that is the course, and this course has clinical relevance. Why we are scared of antirhythmoidal artery? Lot of people have queries regarding this artery may get injured and
so
what is going to happen? See, to understand that physiology or the complication, we need to understand this course. And there are two sides of major complication which can occur by means of injuring the antirhythmoidal artery. It's not the bleeding which is a major complication from the antirhythmoidal artery. This caliber of this antirhythmoidal artery is almost 1/50th of what the caliber of internal carotid or the common carotid artery is.
Okay.
So, and we, our head and neck surgeons, we deal with the carotid artery and other major arteries, maxillary artery. So this is hardly anything in terms of producing
volume,
bleeding.
The diameter. Okay.
So bleeding is hardly anything. Even if it bleeds, you place a simple cotton ball for a minute or two, or a gel foam, whatever you have in your hand,
some pressure.
It will stop.
Okay.
So the concern is mainly at two places. One, where it leaves the orbit and run into the roof of the ethmoidal cavity. That bony canal is known as orbitocranial canal, from the orbit to the cranial cavity.
Okay.
So if this artery happens to get injured at the level where it leaves the orbit into the ethmoid and gets transected,
yeah,
it may retract into the orbit, and that can lead to a disaster, number one. Why? If it retracts into the orbit, if it keeps on bleeding inside the orbit, orbit cannot accommodate this extra blood. We know orbit is a closed compartment. All around the bony walls are there except the anterior wall, which is the diaphragm, fibrotendinous diaphragm. That can expand to some extent. The bony walls can't expand. So if the blood accumulates in the orbit by means of bleeding of this antirhythmoidal artery, is going to exert pressure on the vital structure in the orbit, like the optic nerve, the ciliary vessels and the retinal arteries and the other things. So if this artery keeps on bleeding into the orbit after retracting from this injury, it can compress this vital structure. And if it is not managed promptly, a picture is coming, if it is not managed promptly, it can lead to a permanent visual loss. So that is one concern. Okay.
Yeah.
And the second concern is where it leaves the orbitocranial canal, where it perforates the lateral lamella. See, that is the thinnest point of the skull base. We all know the lateral lamella of cribriform, where this artery perforates, is 0.05 mm. So we know this artery cannot be injured by a simple force. The injury which is too severe to have injured the artery or close to the lateral lamella can easily hit the lateral lamella and get a CSF leak.
Yeah, okay. So it's not the artery.
At that point, CSF leak is a major concern rather than injury to the artery.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
Okay. So we'll discuss now. I think we are getting the picture. Kya hua? Aray, aa gaya tha na abhi, kya hua? Lose contact. Ashish.
I have just replaced him for a while.
Hello.
I have just replaced him for a while.
Yeah.
You can continue. Yeah, he's just gone out to make a phone call.
ये दिखाओ ना, ओए एक्सटर्नल कैमरा जरा लाना इधर. हेलो आशीष,
आशीष हैज जस्ट गॉन आउट टू मेक अ फोन कॉल.
मैडम मैडम,
या
या आर यू गेटिंग द एक्सटर्नल कैमरा पिक्चर?
नॉट रियली.
और यू ओए कन्वर्ट टू द एंडोस्कोपिक पिक्चर प्लीज.
अभी आ गया था.
ओके ओके, वी गेट बैक टू आवर.
यू आर ऑन द पिक्चर?
यस.
आर यू गेटिंग द पिक्चर?
यस.
ओके मैडम, थैंक यू. मैडम,
यस.
सो फार आई होप ऑल आर ओरिएंटेड.
यस, वेरी वेल.
ओके, सो आई हैव चेंज टू द जीरो डिग्री नाउ एंड आई विल शो यू विद द जीरो डिग्री व्हाट वी हैव डन विद द 70 डिग्री सो फार. ओके,
यस.
ये दूसरा, ये दोनों यार, ये साला सेवन अटकता है. हम्म, यस. सी दिस इज द मिडिल टर्बिनेट. There above is the frontal sinus.
Yes.
This is the skull base.
Yes.
Here roughly we will get the entrance model artery, which is not prominent in this case.
Mm-hmm.
And here is the remnant of the bulla we have removed. And this is the lamina preparatia.
Yes.
Lamina preparatia above. And this is the maxillary sinus ostium.
Correct.
So now I am removing the remnant of the bulla with a zero degree. Is everybody oriented?
Yes.
Yes, surely.
Please, if anybody has any doubt or anything.
Are you all oriented? Yes.
Okay, so I am removing the remnant of all these. In live surgical situation, we are not supposed to pull this mucosa and strip it and making the. Oye, chal nahi raha. Nahi nahi, chalo, chalo, ruko. Yes.
Friends, not only this session but the entire conference we have planned to be very, very interactive, and I would always like you to ask questions, give your opinions, and you can definitely put forth your questions right away as well.
Yes, now. Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. So I was mentioning that this redundant mucosa should never be pulled. Either use a through biting, and whenever possible, the best instrument to be used is the micro debrider.
Okay.
See, it is a mucosa sparing equipment.
Mm-hmm.
See. Now, another important thing here I want to mention is, can you see some cells? Cell extending inferior to the orbit here?
Yes, there.
Can you see towards the maxillary sinus?
Yes, yes.
To me, this is the Heller cell.
Heller cell.
Infraorbital ethmoidal cell is known as Heller cell. All these fancy named cells in the paranasal sinuses. Fancy name means this Heller cell, Onodi cell, frontal cell, Kun cell, Agar-Naji cell.
They all
these are basically ethmoidal cells pneumatizing the surrounding bones. So this is the Heller cell, the ethmoidal cell pneumatizing the maxillary bone here at this angle. So
yeah.
Whenever you come across this, this is not very big.
Not, yeah.
If it is big, it can compromise the maxillary sinus outflow.
Yeah.
So whenever you find this, the best is to communicate, remove the party wall between this and the maxillary sinus and communicate this with the maxillary sinus proper. Okay?
Yeah.
Even if there is no disease or polyp there.
Yes, suction nahi chal raha, kya nahi chal
raha. Yeah, to widen the whole thing.
Yeah.
Ashish.
Yeah.
So this was looking like the Heller cell.
Fantastic.
So now we have removed the bulla completely. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now our next step would be, see, now you see the second part of the middle turbinate in view.
Yeah.
Complete view. This is the ground lamella.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, as we know, the ground lamella separates the anterior group of ethmoidal cells from the posterior group of ethmoidal cells. Okay? So we need to enter into the posterior group of ethmoidal cells. And the important thing is where to enter into the ground lamella. See, this is the first part. This is the curvature turning into the second part. So point of this transition from the first to the second part, and at the level of the upper border of the maxillary sinus.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
Can you correlate?
Yeah, very well. Very well.
Here, if you enter by means of your forceps, by means of your micro debrider or anything, now see, we are in the posterior ethmoid.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
So this is the safest point. Why? If we enter above, we may hit the skull base. Okay?
Yeah.
So, now, moment you enter the post-sigmoid, now, here I am going to again emphasize on our technique, how we go about the further dissection. Yeah.
This is another game-changing technique. Watch. Safest, fastest, efficient. Not fastest, okay. Most efficient.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is the posterior ethmoidal cells coming into the view.
Yeah.
Now, we saw on the CT scan, the movement posterior ethmoid starts in the medial wall, superior turbinate comes into the picture.
Here. Yeah.
So, the if we see like the frontal sinus or the frontal recess, this posterior ethmoid sinuses are again like a box, structures contained in a box bounded laterally by in its entirety anterior to posterior by the lamina papyracea and
block.
Similarly medially it's blocked, suction block, medially in entirety from anterior to posterior by the
superior
turbinate.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hmm.
And medial to the superior turbinate we know is
so that is the superior turbinate.
No,
yeah.
No, this is not superior turbinate.
No. More medially, Yeah,
that's
no,
right.
We could.
I'm bringing my divider and showing how to show the superior turbinate.
Yeah.
See,
so the
we have entered the posterior ethmoid here.
Yes.
Now it is recommended to make the opening medially. See, this is middle turbinate.
Yeah, very nice, Satish.
Just behind the middle turbinate, make an opening between the middle and the superior turbinate. Can you see some structure coming
very
into the
nicely?
View?
Yes.
And what? This is superior turbinate.
Yes.
So this window.
So
medially between the middle and the superior turbinate. This leads to the sphenoethmoidal recess and here is the sphenoid ostium.
Yeah. So just zoom out. So the superior turbinate should be almost bisecting this window.
Yeah.
You know, don't fall short. Take it away a little bit more. Keep the superior turbinate almost in the center of the window. That way you can work medially. Yeah. Okay, Satish.
Yes. So the moment we enter the posterior ethmoid, we are not dissecting the posterior ethmoidal cells.
Yes.
We have seen the superior turbinate and then staying medial to it between the superior turbinate and septum, you can easily go to the sphenoid sinus and in the pathological situation, you can widen the sphenoid
Look
sinus.
How much of it was very wide, just mucosal inferiorly.
Yeah.
So the change of color was telling you, but before I could point out.
Yeah. While widening this ostium, one has to be careful. Number one, it should be widened medially first and flush with the posterior part of the nasal septum. Okay,
this is something important. This today morning Satish taught me doing surgery. This limit is also, it should be flushed in line to the septum.
Then secondly, one should not be over enthusiastic and widen it inferiorly. Below the ostium there is branch of the sphenopalatine artery known as nasal septal branch runs on the anterior face of the sphenoid. So this ostium should not be widened too much inferiorly to preserve that branch. Okay?
At least at this point of time. Yeah.
Now another important thing at this point, before even dissecting the posterior ethmoidal cells, I would recommend to remove the lower half of the superior turbinate.
Yeah, because now by now I think we are only concerned about injury to the optic nerve and the fear of carotid. These two things start coming in our mind. Now this technique is something which is again fantastic.
You raised a very valid point, Ashish.
Yeah.
Why did I do all this?
Yes.
Why did I not go straight away posteriorly and remove the posterior ethmoidal cells? Because I want to preserve certain structures, the critical neurovascular structures lying in the posterior superior wall of the sphenoid. Okay?
Yes.
Suppose I go directly from here into the sphenoid, I may damage if there is Onodi cell, if there is any dissent optic nerve, any dissent carotid artery, and I never know where the posterior ethmoid is ending and when the sphenoid is starting.
Correct.
So to get a landmark, this is a very constant landmark, I made a window between the superior turbinate and the middle turbinate, went medial to it, widened the sphenoid ostium. Now this ostium is a constant landmark for me. Now I will dissect the entire posterior ethmoidal cells, keeping myself anterior to the ostium of the sphenoid.
So this plane, this vertical plane will stick to the anterior wall of the sphenoid as it goes laterally, and again anything that is anterior to that is garbage.
Yes, is a garbage. You can remove all these septa.
Yeah.
See, my landmark is anterior wall of the sphenoid.
Yeah.
In any circumstance,
he will
the
not
carotid artery and optic nerve cannot come anterior to the
anterior
wall of the sphenoid or the ostium of the sphenoid.
So
if you develop this landmark and then dissect the posterior ethmoidal cells anterior to it, you can never injure the optic nerve or the carotid artery. So to develop this landmark, I went in after opening the posterior ethmoid and opened the sphenoid sinus first. So just to get a landmark.
Yeah,
block. See now, dissection of the posterior ethmoid. Again like a box, my lateral limit is going to be lamina as usual from above to below, anterior to posterior. My posterior limit of this posterior ethmoid surgery is the anterior wall of sphenoid. Now after completing this posterior ethmoidal work, a little bit of work is left here.
Yeah.
Chal nahi raha boss ye. Nahi chal raha. Isme blade mein gadbad hai yaar. Gadbad hai, main bata raha hu. You have any other straight blade? Ye de do, 12 de do. Yes. See Ashish.
He's gone out for a phone call, yeah.
Yes. So, now, see the panoramic view of the paranasal sinuses using the 0 degree. Now, the remaining septa in the posterior ethmoid.
Yeah. Okay?
I know I cannot injure the optic nerve as long as I stay anterior to the sphenoidal ostium.
Right, yeah.
So this is the philosophy behind creating this landmark.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Now, to go behind, see this is the anterior wall of the sphenoid.
Yeah.
I will, you can use various instruments to widen it. You can use a Carrison punch, you can use a mushroom punch, you can use a micro drill, you can use a through biting. But simply I use in my practice generally is the micro debrider.
Right.
See now I am widening the sphenoid sinus.
Yeah.
See now this was our posterior limit. We considered the wall we are removing, we considered as the posterior limit of our posterior ethmoid dissection.
Right.
Okay. Hmm. Now once we remove it, see how far are the optic and the carotid.
We can appreciate it.
Yeah. I will focus on all these structures once I widen this sphenoidotomy. I am widening it for the sake of
demonstration,
showing the anatomy. Yes.
Yeah.
My focus here in this dissection would be more and more anatomy.
Right.
And if time permits, I am going to show you the origin till the end point of all the cranial nerves, right from the first nerve arising in the brain to the 12th nerve arising from the brain stem.
Right, right.
Okay. And how they supply the head and neck region. Okay. Now, suction. Now we see the interior of the sphenoid sinus. Okay.
Yes,
sir. Okay. So this is the interior of the sphenoid sinus after removing the anterior wall of the sphenoid. Now see the important structures coming into the view. Hello.
Yes, Adish. Yeah.
Yeah. See, this was the nasal septum.
Yeah.
And this is the intersinus septum.
Yes.
Septum between the two sphenoid sinuses, medially.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Laterally, this is the orbit.
Yes.
And it is ending like a cone here. This is orbital apex.
Apex, yeah.
And here, this is the optic
canal.
Yeah. Going medially to join the other optic nerve and forming the optic chiasma.
Right.
Here. Now, superior to the optic canal, this is the planum sphenoidal.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, this recess, we saw on the CT scan as well.
Yeah.
This pneumatization, see, this is the carotid artery. Can you see?
Right, yes. Yeah, visible.
This is the cavernous carotid artery. This is the anterior genu of the carotid artery. I'll classify, I'll enumerate the classification of the various segments of the carotid. This is the anterior genu of the cavernous carotid artery. And this is the optic now.
Yeah.
And this pneumatization, this is basically the region of the optic strut, which is a part of anterior clinoid process, which is a part of lesser wing of sphenoid. And here is the clivus. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, see, this is the anterior genu of the carotid artery. Now, we for all the skull-based approaches, it is the most important thing to understand is the anatomy of the sphenoid bone. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what is a sphenoid bone? Just within a minute, I will classify the various parts of the sphenoid bone so that we understand it better. This is the body of the sphenoid bone containing both sides of the sphenoid sinuses. Now, there are three processes on either side from the sphenoid bone. Above is the lesser wing of sphenoid, below is the greater wing of sphenoid, and inferiorly on either side are the two processes, pterygoid processes, from the body of the sphenoid. Is that clear?
Yes.
From the lesser wing, the various parts of the lesser wing are the anterior clinoid process, or from which the optics start, and the planum sphenoidal. Planum sphenoid is the part of lesser wing of sphenoid.
Okay.
Then the greater wing of sphenoid, which forms the floor of the middle cranial fossa. All these foramina, like foramen rotundum, foramen ovale laterally, foramen spinosum far laterally, all these open into the skull base in the greater wing of sphenoid. So that is greater wing. On both sides from the sphenoid are the pterygoid processes. This is maxillary sinus.
Yeah.
Behind this is the pterygopalatine fossa.
Yes.
Behind which are the pterygoid process on both sides.
Yeah.
That process splits into the medial pterygoid plate here and the lateral pterygoid plate far laterally. So this is how this sphenoid anatomy is. And this is important to understand, as majority of the skull base, for majority of the skull base procedure, sphenoid is the epicenter of all the approaches.
Yeah. Okay.
So
understood.
Now, we have opened the sphenoid, seen the structures inside the sphenoid.
Yeah.
Now we move on to the further dissection. Okay, from audience, have you done with the endoscopic sinus surgery on this side?
Sorry?
Are we through on this side with the endoscopic sinus surgery part?
No. Yes. Some more cells to be removed.
Yes.
These
that's
are
what
cells.
I wanted
yes.
to know.
Yes.
See,
yes.
Skull
this
base.
Sphenoid
yeah.
and this form the posterior
skull
part
base.
Of the skull base.
Yeah.
Now, we need to follow this skull base. Can you see?
Yes. Beautiful.
Above.
Yeah.
So, how to follow that?
Yeah.
Give me the divider.
This is the car mechanic.
See this.
So he's gone underneath. Yeah.
Once you see the sphenoid, you know your posterior limit of the skull base, and all these cells anterior to it. Can you see?
Yeah.
See now. Now the skull base is coming into the picture.
Yeah. So you follow it now.
See, this is sphenoid. This is posterior ethmoidal skull base. Is it clear?
Very nice,
yes.
Satish.
Now,
fantastic.
In this plane, if we keep on removing all these cells.
See, again he's using an angled burr.
Yeah. See what happens in endoscopic sinus surgery if we leave the cells behind. See, the underlying cause of the polyp is the allergy. That remains same. So if we leave the cells behind and remove only the diseased cell, the other cells with the same underlying cause can develop the mucosal edema, aeration block, and the recurrent polyps again. So it is better to excentrate all the cells in the first go so to prevent the polyp formation. And I have Dr. Gaurav with me here in the dissection, who is working with me, and he is doing a study and presenting in Dubai in the April on this innovative technique of complete excentration of all these cells to prevent the recurrence in endoscopic sinus surgery. And believe me, we have approached almost 100% in preventing the recurrence of polyp by this complete excentration approach and the proper follow-up. See now, the skull base.
Yes, fantastic.
See, this entire skull base is skeletonized. So if you don't remove these cells, they become the niders of
yes.
the recurrent polyps.
Now you are going towards the frontal.
Yeah, blocked. See now.
Yeah.
This is the paranasal sinus labyrinth. Paranasal sinus corridor. See, this corridor leads to the skull base. Skull base is here.
Yeah.
So if we use both the paranasal sinuses corridor, remove the middle turbinate, remove the part of the nasal septum, we have a common cavity and a direct approach to the skull base. So this endoscopic approach nowadays has become, this nose has become a highway to address the lesions not only of the skull base,
so
but
even the… Wait. Remove that. Explain. Let us watch it. Yeah.
Pardon?
Don't remove it just like that. Make commentary when you are removing that. Now you are.
The brighter. So I have completely skeletonized this paranasal sinus corridor now on this side. Okay?
Yeah. So orient us with the frontal.
Ashish,
yeah, Satish.
The important thing again for the juniors to keep the mucosa intact.
Yes.
See everywhere. Everywhere it is lined
so
by the
mucosa.
Mucosa
within the cells is sacrificed,
yes,
but not on the walls. That's
see,
what that carpet is all
let
about.
Let me show you. Let me lift up the mucosa and show you how it is draping the cells. Can you see?
Yeah, very nice. Yeah.
See this? So everywhere mucosa is
preserved.
This is of utmost importance.
Yeah.
Stenberger calls it as mucosal wallpaper.
Hmm.
If you leave this mucosa draped over the your sinus cavity walls, it is like a canal down mastoidectomy technique for endoscopic sinus surgery. You excentrate all the cells,
yeah,
leave the limits in view. See the lateral limit lamina, medial limit turbinate, posterior limit, this posterior level of the frontal sinus and the skull base. No cell is left. Where would the unaeration take place? Where would the polyp come from? So this is how you can prevent the recurrence of polyp by this approach. Okay?
Yeah. And Satish,
yeah,
good luck for Gaurav, because Moaz, the chief of that conference, is here in the auditorium watching.
Oh.
It. Moaz?
Hey, so,
Ashim, very man, when did you come? Ashim is here.
Oh.
He's just making sure you're not making a mistake.
Absolutely. Welcome. Welcome.
I'm witnessing your fabulous dissection. Super, super.
Oh.
We have to learn from you.
Thank you. So Dr. Tarabich is here.
Yeah.
And I think he has seen the.
But he's looking for the corda. The moment he gets the endoscope, it is either staphy.
We'll show him the corda from the nasal cavity today.
Really?
Dr. Tarabich.
You are blind to show the corda from the nasal,
yeah,
cavity.
We'll see the course of the corda, how it comes out of the petrotympanic fissure and joins the lingual nerve and supplies
transnasal endoscopic otology.
Yes. Corda tympanic. Yes. So now, Ashish,
yeah,
looking at the time constraint,
yeah,
we should move on.
Go ahead, move it.
So
yes,
my next dissection would be,
yeah,
before going to,
yeah,
the skull base,
I'll
show some other surrounding region.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, first important, see, we can access the maxillary sinus from here.
Yeah.
Now, if we have a lesion far laterally in the maxillary sinus.
Satish, sorry to bother you.
Yeah.
Can you with the 70 just show the entire, because this is where usually our fest ends.
What?
With a 70 degree, show the entire frontal and this.
Okay,
this
in
entire,
one view.
Yeah, in one view. Yeah.
One view, yes.
Yeah, because this is what generally will be the surgery for polyposis.
Yes, that's why I like this,
yeah,
70 degree.
Yeah.
And believe me, if I am given only one telescope to accomplish the entire face, my choice is 70 degree, not the 0 degree.
Yeah.
This 70 degree is so versatile. See, you see all the sinuses in one view.
Yeah.
You can do your work with a 70 degree. If you change the angle.
Yeah, you've gone into the corner.
Make the telescope vertical, you make it 0 degree.
Hmm.
If you place it horizontal, you make it 120 degree. See?
Hmm.
How versatile is the 70 degree telescope? So, if I am given a single telescope, I'll opt for 70,
yeah,
degree.
But so
now, into the maxillary sinus and,
wow,
the anterior wall.
Yeah.
This is the far anterior wall. Ashish, you were asking,
yeah,
in the morning.
Yeah, axis, yeah, yeah.
Okay. So now some important points for the maxillary sinus here. If we have a lesion in the pterygopalatine fossa far behind, it is sometimes difficult to access if the lesion is extending laterally through purely this endonasal approach.
Yeah.
Now what can be done further? So now our approach, that is approach we have now publishing, is the pre-lacrimal approach to the lateral part of the maxillary sinus, lateral part of the infratemporal fossa, pterygopalatine fossa, and even up to the middle cranial fossa. So that is pre-lacrimal approach.
Pre-lacrimal approach.
Yeah,
so
I'll show what exactly it is. Okay, that requires a sort of medial maxillectomy, modified medial maxillectomy. I will show quickly. Before that, okay, let me show there are a lot of junior guys.
Sphenopalatine.
The DCR. Because that part,
yeah,
will be removed otherwise. Okay, So I will show quickly the anatomy of the nasolacrimal system. See, we have seen the साफ करना यार नहीं गीला रखो गीला कॉटन रखो गीला रखो यार आई वांट टू गीला गीला हाँ यस यस ओके आशीष
या
वी हैव सीन दिस मैक्सिलरी साइनस ऑस्टियम
यस
व्हाइल यूजिंग द रिवर्स बाइटिंग
या
एज मेंशन वी शुड बी केयरफुल व्हाइल गोइंग फर्दर एंटीरियरली एज देयर इज द nasolacrimal system.
Yeah.
Now, if I remove this mucosa, just for the sake of anatomy, I will show how this nasolacrimal system runs in the lateral wall of the nose. Okay?
Yeah.
I am removing this mucosa just to show the anatomy. See this?
Yeah.
We have seen the Hessner wall from below.
Yeah.
Now we see how this system runs. Give me the debrider. I am removing this mucosa. Then after the DCR, I will show the pre-lacrimal approach to the far lateral area. See, I have debrided this mucosa of this area. This area is known as atrium. This is a flat area. Now, this nasolacrimal duct is composed of three bones. See this?
Yeah.
Medially, there are two bones. Above is the lacrimal bone and below, here is the lacrimal process of the inferior turbinate. Okay?
Okay.
And laterally on the outer side is formed by the thick frontonasal process. So, to uncover this nasolacrimal system from medial side, give me the kerosene. To uncover this, our approach to the DCR is not look for the sac from the beginning. We open the nasolacrimal duct from below. See this?
Yeah.
You remove this bone and you are at the nasolacrimal system directly. Can you press from outside? Can you see the nasolacrimal duct?
Yeah.
Entire system?
Yeah.
So uncover this bone. Uncover this bone. I make a flap of like a... You open the book of the entire nasolacrimal system. Not only the sac, but the entire nasolacrimal duct even. See now. Can you see this?
Yes.
This is the nasolacrimal duct, and if you go up, you can remove even the sac.
Satish, in the live patient, do you take, what sort of a mucosal flap do you take? A superior flap, base flap,
in the
or
live,
an anterior?
Yes, yes, that's an important point, boss. Yeah. In the live situation, my flap is like, this is the axilla.
Yeah.
This is the axilla here.
Axillary base
I
flap.
I make a rhomboid incision, one centimeter above the axilla.
Yeah.
Superiorly, coming anteriorly at the junction of the up to the vestibule, not into the vestibule, up to the vestibule, make a vertical incision anteriorly up to the upper border of the inferior turbinate,
yeah,
and then further posteriorly and raise this flap posteriorly completely so that I deposit it back at the end of the procedure so as not to leave the raw area.
Fine.
Now, can you see this nasolacrimal system?
Very nicely seen.
Now, if you remove this bone of the inferior turbinate, see how it passes through the inferior turbinate. Give me the kerosene. This is important to dissect the nasolacrimal duct in the pre-lacrimal approach so as to avoid the epiphora in the post-operative period. So the you dissect this duct, leave it superiorly, and then do a formal DCR at the end of the process. See this? I am elevating this duct completely.
Superb.
See, this is the lateral frontonasal process.
Yeah.
Now here, see, this is the duct
going into the
Here, give me the scissors. This was just to show the anatomy. I will take a scissors, cut it. अरे यार काटती नहीं है भाई. Stores क्या करते हो? See, this is the duct. Okay?
Yeah.
So I am just lifting it up, keeping away from my area from the lateral nasal wall. See this? I am just lifting it up and placing it superiorly. Okay?
Mm.
Now, there is no important structure in this region. Can you see? In the lateral nasal wall. Do you see any important?
Yeah.
So now, if I remove this wall from here, See, this is the vestibule. This is the anterior limit of this wall. Here, raise a flap. See this bony edge. Raise a flap. This is the anterior wall of the maxilla. Can you see?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, very nicely.
This is where we make the Caldwell opening.
Yeah.
Okay? So from the nasal cavity side, I raise this flap and just use a Gaussian hammer and remove this entire nasal.
Just show us from the outside. Just get your scope out.
Yeah, yeah, outside, yeah, nothing. Yeah.
Now put your instrument in there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So that's the piriform, yes, aperture.
Are you oriented?
Yes. Piriform, yes, aperture.
Fantastic. Yeah.
So now our ostium is here. Our lateral wall is free of the nasolacrimal duct.
Yeah.
And now this, if you remove this wall completely.
Yeah.
See, this outside mucosa is preserved.
Yeah.
If you remove this, you have a highway access to the lateral compartment, to the infratemporal fossa. I will show.
Chalo,
give me the Gaussian hammer, please.
Do you reposit that bone back?
Yes.
And you wire it in?
This flap?
No, the bone, when you remove it, what is the Gauss hammer?
This bone?
Yeah. When you remove it with the Gauss hammer, do you reposit it back in the live patient?
No. No way. This communicates with the nasal cavity. The maxillary sinus communicates with the nasal cavity. Now, see, boss. Yes, Gauss hammer. Yes, thok. Fast thok. George, dam nahi hai yaar. Amol.
Kone hai? Arvind hai kya? Kone thok hai?
Amol.
Amol, okay. Bas, itne se thok jata hai. Ho gaya?
Thoko. Ho gaya. See now. This bone is gone?
Gone.
If you remove this bone, to remove this, ideally we should have a stout forceps or sort of, I would say, the lux or something. Do we have?
No, you just got to pick it up. Yeah.
Give me the artery otherwise. See, ideally we should have a lux or something to remove this segment. Maybe it has come. Remove with the artery forceps. Okay, give me the debrider. Hello?
Yeah.
Now see,
watching. Yeah.
The excess we get with this approach.
Abhi maxillary to lag gayi.
Maxillary pura laga di iski. Now you see the entire maxillary sinus from the nasal cavity.
Posterior, okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
You can remove this up to the floor without any problem. See now, Ashim was asking,
including the inflated bit, yeah,
replacement of the flap. Yes, we can replace the flap, or we can leave it communicated with the nasal cavity as such.
We lost the endoscope picture. Okay, we are back. Yeah.
See now.
Yeah.
Okay, now.
That's the inferior turbinate. You're going to sacrifice. Yes.
You can resect it. You can debride it. You can remove this further. Actually, if you have a strong suction, Ashish, I tell go for a liposuction.
Yeah.
You can remove all, do this all bone work in no time.
You need, Satish has told us, you need a one, what Satish?
Liposuction, 1 horsepower.
1 horsepower
and horsepower.
This thing for the debrider, that way the blades last longer and the efficiency of the system is very good.
Our usual
suction machine that we use for otology are 0.25.
So if you use a liposuction machine 1 horsepower, your life of the blade will be 3 times. Otherwise, you keep on cutting with the blade without the suction backup, and the blade, you ruin the blade basically. You ruin the motor of the debrider. So now, can you see?
Yes.
The access to the maxillary sinus. See in the roof, the infraorbital?
Yep.
Complex.
Now, yes, very nicely seen now.
Now, depending upon the pathology, you can further widen it. Okay?
Further?
Yes. You remove this wall further.
Okay.
Like for the JNAs extending, angiofibromas extending far laterally.
Yeah.
This is my preferred technique. And now, majority, over 90% of the angiofibroma, however extending they are, You can remove them endoscopically.
Endoscopy. I have seen him do an orbital apex tumor from this approach. Fantastic.
Okay, now. See now, why I remove this, to show the anatomy of the pterygopalatine fossa and the infratemporal fossa. Now, to begin with, the most important structure in this region is the sphenopalatine foramen, housing the sphenopalatine artery. See this. This is the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone. Can you see?
Yes.
Yep.
This is a very, very important structure to
there
understand.
It is. Bingo.
See, yeah. I am raising this flap and show you something inferiorly. This perpendicular plate of the palatine bone forms the medial wall of the posterior wall of the maxillary sinus, posterior part of the maxillary sinus. This forms the medial wall of the posterior part of the maxillary sinus.
Yeah.
Here this bone has three processes. If you notice, see superiorly, it divides into two processes. Can you see this dip?
Very nicely seen.
This one process going anteriorly to the orbit.
Yeah.
That is the orbital process.
Yeah.
And one process going behind, see this, towards the body of the sphenoid.
Yes.
That is sphenoidal process.
Very nicely
and seen. Above this comes the sphenoid body.
Mm.
So here it is forming the sphenopalatine foramen. Can you see this?
Yeah.
This is the site of the sphenopalatine foramen.
Yeah.
Here this gives an anterior process here. Here this is the anterior process for the insertion of the inferior turbinate which we have removed.
Yeah.
Okay, now to see this, to locate this inferior sphenopalatine foramen, this is important to understand this anatomy. Raise this mucosal flap here, go up to the two processes of the vision of the palatine bone, perpendicular plate of the palatine bone. Can you see this structure coming out?
Yes, we can see it very well.
Sometimes this bone overhangs in this area.
Yeah.
To remove that overhang, you can simply use your Carrison punch and uncover the sphenopalatine area completely. Like this. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, me and Ashim, Ashish did a
today morning,
in the morning, one sphenopalatine ligation in his center. See, this is the artery. Can you see the?
Yeah, very nice.
Glimpse of the vessel?
Yeah.
Sometimes this artery divides even before coming out the sphenopalatine foramen into the various branches. Here it is coming out of the foramen here clearly and dividing into two branches. Can you see?
Yeah.
This anterior branch, Ashish, if you remember in the morning.
Yeah.
It goes in the inferior turbinate. Can you see?
Yes.
This
yes,
becomes
that was the one which was
this becomes the pedicle of the inferior turbinate flap.
Oh.
Inferior turbinate flap is another important
vascular,
flap for the skull base reconstruction. This side we have removed the inferior turbinate. I will show on the other side how to raise the inferior turbinate flap. Okay.
Okay.
So this is based on this anterior branch of the sphenopalatine artery. Okay.
Okay.
Then one branch going posteriorly, see this,
yeah,
this goes posteriorly and runs along the here, see it is here going posteriorly
that, yeah on the coina
and runs on the anterior face of the sphenoid.
Sphenoid, yes.
The nasoseptal artery,
yeah,
this becomes the pedicle of the Haddad flap.
Flaps, yeah.
Haddad flap was designed by two Argentinian skull based surgeon, the Haddad and the Basagesge, who devised this flap. This is the most versatile, robust flap for the skull base reconstruction. After this step, I'll show how to raise the Haddad flap. So see, if you have to do a wide sphenoidotomy in the floor, here, raise this mucoperiosteum first. See like this, to preserve this pedicle and then punch this bone. Okay? Hello?
Yeah, Satish, yeah. Super.
So raise this mucoperiosteum first.
Yeah.
To protect this pedicle. In this is the pedicle for the Haddad flap.
Yeah.
And then punch this bone. So this is known as rescue flap. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, so we have seen the region of the sphenopalatine artery here.
Yeah.
Now let us correlate how it comes out of the sphenopalatine or the pterygopalatine fossa. So to the see that we'll remove the first this medial wall, this perpendicular plate. See?
Yeah, very
nicely.
You can
remove. Sometimes if it is hard, you need to use punch. Sometimes you may have to use a drill, whatever. Then remove the mucosa or the posterior wall of the maxillary sinus. Okay?
Yeah.
Give me the 40, right 40. See, remove this bone. Remove this bone, carry some. And we'll move on to the pterygopalatine fossa area.
We lost the endoscope picture. Huh? Okay, we are back. Yeah.
Fine?
Yeah.
See, Ashish?
Yeah.
I remove this bone and you can see the artery.
Artery very nicely already.
See,
yeah.
In the pterygopalatine fossa, the structures are placed in various layers.
In various layers?
Yes.
Okay.
The most anteriorly, just behind this wall, is a pad of fat.
Okay.
Just behind that is the vascular layer.
Okay.
Where there run the various branches, the main artery and the various branches of this sphenopalatine artery.
Yeah.
And behind that is the neural layer, the layer of nerves. And there are four important neural structures which run in the posterior wall. We are going to see just now.
Okay. So this is the fat that is facing us right now. The first layer is the fat.
This is the periosteum.
Yeah.
See the periosteum and the fat behind.
Yes. Yeah.
So we need to remove this entire wall.
Okay.
So see the excess now.
Yeah.
See the excess with the carison now.
Yeah, yeah. Fantastic.
With this approach.
Yeah.
You can go right up to here.
Yeah.
If you want to further go, you can remove this.
Mm.
So this gives unparalleled access to the infratemporal fossa. This carison is not good. It's called storage.
Satish, doctors want to know where do you put the probe to cauterize the vessel?
To cauterize the?
Sphenopalatine vessel.
Yes, that is important point, madam. I'll show the various ways to handle this artery. See, this is the artery behind this. I will expose the artery completely. If you are doing for the epistaxis only, you need not to expose the entire pterygopalatine fossa far laterally. You just expose this artery, the trunk of the vessel here, after removal of this crest here. Once you remove the crest, the artery is exposed and you can simply cauterize it, or you can use a Liga clips. So, but we use in our practice, I practically use the simple cauterization using a monopolar cautery.
It's very important to get the entire lumen of the artery in your forceps.
Yes, in the
that is important. How much do you remove? You should be able to, in one bite, get it all and then cauterize. If you do it partially, then it starts bleeding. So they
See, at this point I am removing the bone forming the roof of the pterygopalatine fossa.
Forming the roof of the
fractured this bone and I'm removing this. See now that this pterygopalatine fossa and its relationship with the sphenoid.
Yes, beautifully seen.
And the structures arising from it, how they go into the sphenoid. I am going to make it very, very crystal clear.
Yes,
there are four neural structures in the pterygopalatine fossa. The V2, the maxillary nerve, the pterygopalatine ganglion, the VDN nerve, and the pharyngeal nerve. Their relationship to each other, their relationship to the this sphenoid, and their relationship to the artery, the sphenopalatine artery. Okay, so this is what I am doing is exposing the pterygopalatine fossa completely.
Because
if you remember, we saw the pterygopalatine fossa in the CT scan.
Yes, yes, you showed it on the right side though, but
see this bone.
Yeah.
Sometimes it is papery thin. You can simply fracture with your cautels, your periosteum. If it is thick, you need to use bone punch. If it is too thick for the bone punch, you can even use the micro drill.
So is this also a vascular bed during surgery? Is there a lot of oozing and things like that here?
No. As long as this periosteum
is intact, okay.
Nothing happens.
Okay. Fantastic.
See now, we have exposed
almost 1 centimeter or more of the medial part. Yeah.
Yes.
Half of the course. Fantastic, Satish.
This
superb. Yeah. Now,
for this step, you need, there are various angled carison punches available now.
Okay.
But see, I am using the straight one.
One
because I have a full access.
Yes, exposure.
This is provided by this pre-lacrimal approach.
Yeah.
See, I am going far laterally.
Yeah.
Without an issue. See, what I have separated here, what I am trying to show is the infraorbital nerve.
Yes, you are tracing
it.
See
in the roof?
Yeah, very nicely.
If you follow this, what is this? This is continuation of the V2. Infraorbital is basically the continuation of V2. See, this is the infraorbital nerve.
Yeah.
Can you see?
Yeah, very nicely.
See, I am opening this pterygopalatine fossa full wide.
As you go laterally, what do you open into?
Pterygomaxillary fissure through which we will enter the infratemporal fossa.
Okay.
We are going to. I will show.
Yeah.
Give me the suction please to remove all these small, small pieces. वॉश में भी नहीं आएगा मोटा सेक्शन देना सी दिस इज द pterygopalatine fossa
या
जो मैं सिकल सिकल दे दो नाउ आई विल इनसाइज द पेरिओस्टियम हियर सी दिस
ओके
विद अ सिकल नाइफ
ओके
सतीश जनरली यू गेट अ लार्ज प्लेक्सस ऑफ वेन्स आउट हियर हाउ डू यू अवॉइड इट
देयर आर बिलीव मी anteriorly first you come across the fat see this don't come across any vessel directly
now you seeing the vessel
can you see this
fantastic
I am just teasing out this fat the various tortuous vessels their branches the many branches this spinopalatine gives off in the pterygopalatine fossa laterally there is posterior superior alveolar artery medially the descending palatine artery the median artery that is inconstant branch can you see this branches
this, yeah
all these branches see this
are we seeing some nerves there or is this small
no, these are vessels
okay
see anteriorly all these are vessels
okay
now follow this medially follow this where is our artery see this main artery
yep
How is the picture there?
Very super, nice, super. Fantastic. It's mind blowing.
See this caliber of this artery.
Yeah.
This is the continuation of maxillary artery.
Yeah.
Which is a branch of a terminal branch of external carotid artery. For sure.
It's fabulous.
Now, give me the divider, please, to tease out this fat. See Ashish?
Yes, Satish.
I am just gently trying to use this divider to tease out this fat very, very carefully. Okay.
It does it.
Now, this is the artery.
At a very low RPM.
See, we saw the artery at the medial end.
Yeah, very nice, superb,
and
brilliant.
This is the complete the course complete. Of this artery.
Yeah, oh man.
Now, behind the artery
are
the neural structures.
Posterior,
okay? So, I am further teasing out this fat to see the neural structures. See, there are four neural structures. See, this is infraorbital nerve, can you see?
Yeah.
Follow this. This is the continuation of maxillary nerve. V2. How does V2 come into the pterygopalatine fossa? Through the foramen rotundum. So if you follow this, this is the V2 laterally. Can you see?
Yeah, very nicely.
So see, it lies in a posterior plane.
Yes.
This is the artery in the anterior plane.
Yeah.
This is the posterior plane.
Yeah.
Going laterally, here is the pterygomaxillary fissure where my instrument is going.
Dipping. Yeah, okay.
And here this artery is running in the floor of the orbit and continuing as the infraorbital.
Yeah.
So laterally the four neural structures I mentioned, the lateral most being the V2 and it is coming out of the foramen rotundum here. I will clear everything, all these structures, show you the how the foramen rotundum looks like the relationships, the surrounding relationships of the forum and rotundum, and a direct approach to the cavernous sinus from here. Ashish,
yeah.
If you drill this bone,
yeah.
Directly you are into the middle cranial fossa behind, you are not far away. I will show the approach. And to the cavernous sinus, the lateral part of the cavernous sinus.
So you want me to ask Moaz to wash up for otology?
Pardon?
Should Moaz wash up for the otology procedure? It will come now. He is going to show it.
See now.
If he said he is going to show, he is going to show.
See now.
Yeah.
Under this nerve.
Yeah.
What is this? This is the pterygopalatine ganglion.
Okay. Thoda fine focus hamare.
Haan, karta hoon main. Suspended along the nerve is the pterygopalatine ganglion. See, this is the lateral part of the this thing.
Maxillary.
Pterygopalatine fossa.
Hmm.
Is Dr. Ashim there?
Yeah,
Ashim
is here. Yeah. Hi.
See, Ashish, me and Ashim had a few cases of VDN neurectomy.
Yeah.
We did one day a sort of course where we did 10 VDN neurectomies. Nowadays, I am more and more inclined towards doing median neurectomies in selected cases of extensive polyposis, wherein I divide the median nerves on both sides, and believe me, the results are excellent.
Please listen to this. This is a kind of an extended component of his bilateral face for extensive polyposis in very selected cases.
And I will show you our approach. So, Dr. Ashim,
yeah.
You remember that
day
we did by two approaches. One by after dividing the spinopalatine artery.
Yeah, that's what I did.
You
and
divide
you did
this artery at this point.
Intact. Yeah.
Yes, you divide this artery at this point, and behind would be the median knob.
Correct.
And second is keeping the artery intact. You can see the median now, cauterize it.
Yeah.
Even after keeping the artery intact.
You just have to retract it inferiorly.
Inferiorly.
Inferior retraction, yeah.
That's what I am trying to show. In the live surgical situation, believe me, your
and
life
it is quite tough, this artery to handle.
No.
Tough meaning it's not fragile.
It's not fragile.
You can play with
it's
it.
Quite robust. Fragile. It's quite robust.
Quite robust, yeah.
Yeah, the situation is much better.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can easily recognize with the color, with the feel of the tissue. Can you see some nerves behind? Yes. See, this is the VDN now. This is the V2.
That's V2.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
Here, this thickening at the base of this nerve.
Yes.
This is the pterygopalatine ganglion.
Yeah.
From here, this ganglion, the one nerve arises and one nerve merges. The nerve which merges comes from behind through the VDN canal. That is the VDN now. Okay?
Okay.
A nerve which arises from this is a pharyngeal nerve. So I'll show you this relationship, how it comes. See. Can you see this now?
We can see, but obviously I don't know
this
what is.
This to me looks like VDN now. We'll confirm it.
Yeah.
This is VDN now. You can see.
Okay.
This artery is here.
Yeah.
I have not cut it.
Yeah.
But to show the relationship now.
Hmm. You will cut it.
See, I can do the VDN neurectomy from lift this artery and just cauterize it.
Okay.
But I will cut this artery and show you the relationship, how this nerve comes out of the various foramina. So I am cutting this artery at this level. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, it cut me. Give me the other scissors. Some other scissors. Oh, yes, sir.
Mm.
Yes, not really, behind, I will show. Oh, what a scissors. Ek scissor to mangai lo yaar koi. Ek scissor mangalo na kai. See, I cannot cut, I don't have a scissors here. This artery, once I cut it, we will go in the posterior plane. See this artery?
Okay, yeah.
Being avulsed.
Yeah.
See this two branches?
Fantastic.
And
thank you.
And see just behind it.
Yeah. Very nice, Satish.
The nerves coming into the picture. Can you see?
Yes. Superb.
Now, Ashish, there are three foramina in the posterior wall of the pterygopalatine fossa in the pterygoid process. The one and the lateral most I am going to show you here is the foramen rotundum. see here. From which this V2 is coming out.
Yeah.
See this.
Yeah.
See this. I'll remove this fat. Yeah. Give me the debrider.
So that tip be saaf karo endoscope.
And this is a very important clinical correlation in terms of approaches to the lateral recess of the sphenoid and the cavernous sinus and the middle cranial fossa. This is my preferred approach for many of the tumors of the cavernous sinus and the middle cranial fossa. If you remember, I demonstrated one case in our skull based workshop.
Yes.
The neuroma. See, I am teasing out this tissue to skeletonize this nerve. Can you see this nerve better?
Very well.
So this is foramen rotundum I am trying to expose, and as I mentioned in the beginning, all these fancy named foramen are lying in the greater wing of the sphenoid. Yeah, give me the sickle. See this now going behind, you see?
Yes.
This is the foramen.
Okay.
This is the foramen into which this nerve is going clearly now.
Yes.
You see?
Yeah.
Now if you follow, where does this nerve come out from? If you see in this CT scan we have seen.
Yeah.
This forms the lateral wall of the lateral recess.
Yeah.
If you see the anatomy of the cavernous sinus, very important relationship of this nerve is, this nerve forms, or the level of this nerve is the inferior most level of the cavernous sinus. The cavernous sinus starts above the level of this nerve.
Okay.
See, this is going to, here going to be the cella.
Yeah.
This is the cavernous carotid in the cavernous sinus.
Yeah.
This cavernous sinus extends from above to below, medial to lateral.
Mm-hmm.
The inferior limit is V2. Here is the V2. See this.
Okay.
So, if you drill this bone lateral to it, see this.
Yeah.
Bone lateral to it, drill this, you will reach the middle cranial fossa dura, and where this nerve is a branch of trigeminal nerve. This will take you to the Meckel's cave, the lateral part of the Meckel's cave and the lateral part of the cavernous sinus. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, this is one foramina. Is it clear?
Very clear.
Very clear?
Mm.
Now, the second. Let's go medially now. Further medially. There is another foramina, and to me, that is the most important structure or a landmark in skull-based surgery, the Wiedian nerve. I will show. See now, two foramina.
Yes.
Can you see two foramina?
Yeah, one and one. Yeah.
See, one is going here laterally.
Yes.
And one is going medially.
Yeah.
Give me the suction, please. See, these are medial to the V2. There are two nerves going into these two foramen. The lateral one out of these two is the Wiedian canal, which is medial to the V2. See, this is the V2.
Yeah, we
medial
see.
To this, there are two foramina.
Yeah.
So the junior colleagues, this is important to understand this anatomy. I am just showing.
For,
this
for everybody, sorry, including me.
Can you see these two foramen?
Yeah, very nice.
One is medial, going this, and one is the lateral one.
Yeah.
This lateral one is a wider opening like a funnel.
Yes.
This leads to the Wiedian nerve. Can you see the Wiedian nerve coming out of it?
Very nice.
I will dissect and show it. And see immediately medial to it, another foramen.
Yeah, very
showing
tiny.
Another nerve in the floor of the sphenoid.
Yeah.
See this, I am
we can
retracting,
see
retracting this mucosa, and this is the pharyngeal nerve. See?
Ah,
this
okay.
nerve.
Okay.
Give me the sickle.
Makes sense.
See, this is the pharyngeal nerve. Can you see?
Yeah.
This is the pharyngeal nerve. This is the branch of pterygopalatine fossa.
Yeah.
And this is the VDN nerve.
Yeah.
So, the importance is how this pharyngeal nerve goes into the pterygopalatine. This goes in a canal, palato-vaginal canal. See, we have seen this palatine bone here.
Yeah.
Let me clear you again to orient you. See, this was the palatine bone which we have removed partly. This is the pterygopalatine fossa.
Yeah.
The posterior part of the palatine bone, the sphenoid part. See this?
This is
the orbital process. This is the sphenoid process. So, one part of the canal is formed by this sphenoid process of the
palatine
bone.
Yeah.
And the other part is formed by the vaginal process of the medial pterygoid plate here. So, this formed the palato-vaginal canal where this nerve is leading into. Can you see?
Fantastic.
This is into the floor of the sphenoid.
Yeah.
Now, the another structure in the floor of the sphenoid. See, this is the sphenoid. Just correlate it with the regular structures we see. See, this is the sphenoid.
In the floor. Yeah.
This is the VDN canal.
Okay.
Is Dr. Ashim there?
Yes.
Yes, I am right here.
Boss?
Yeah, boss, udhar kyun nahi pakadne ka VDN ko? Ye sala artery se itna dur
hai. See now. I have cut the pharyngeal nerve.
Yes.
To show you the VDN now, Scholz.
So, by the way, what does the pharyngeal nerve do? What's
the function? It's a sensory nerve to the nasopharynx.
Okay.
See now, what I am doing? I am cutting all this
to
show you the course of the VDN now. Can you see?
Right.
See the funnel shaped opening of the VDN. Ashish?
Perfect. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This is
so
VDN.
So, Satish, tell me to do a VDN neurectomy, why not go through the sphenoid? Is this not safer?
Why not?
Instead of going through the sphenopalatine, yahan pe VDN nerve ko cut karenge to kya hoga?
From the sphenoid?
Haan.
Then it is difficult to, it's not easy to identify from the sphenoid sign.
Because the floor does not have any landmarks. You have to drill the floor and the floor has no landmarks.
Okay.
Now, Ashish.
Yeah.
Now see laterally, we have seen this foramen rotundum.
Yeah.
Clearly.
Very nicely seen. Yeah.
See, I am removing all this tissue.
Yeah.
And medially, you see this foramen to show the VDN now.
Right.
Here.
Yeah. Very nice.
See, I'll remove all this tissue to skeletonize these now. In between, if you drill this pterygoid process, we have seen on the CT scan, in between the VDN and the V2, what is going to be there?
Don't ask questions. Please make comments.
Pardon?
Don't ask questions. Please make comments.
What? You have already answered that. While I was going through the CT scan, I showed in the lateral recess of the sphenoid between the canal of the V2 and the canal of the VDN now.
Yeah.
See, this is the VDN now.
Yeah.
And this is the V2.
Yeah.
If you remove this bone in between, where will it lead to? The lateral recess. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
But it was not on the right side in this cadaver. It was on the right side.
Yeah.
But for the cases we get, now see these two foramen very, very clear.
Superb.
Can you see clearly?
Very nice, Satish.
So, course of the V2, see continuing as the infraorbital now.
Yeah.
Perfect, perfect.
Okay?
Yeah.
This is the VDN now in the floor of the sphenoid. Okay? And this is the pterygoid process. If you drill this pterygoid process, preserving the V2, staying medial to it, you will be nowhere but directly to the lateral recess. Okay? Now, what is the significance of this VDN nerve? See how this VDN nerve is formed. We see in the otology, the GSPN.
Yeah.
The first branch of the facial nerve, it leaves the facial hiatus and runs anteriorly parallel to the carotid artery, and at the level of the foramen lacerum, it joins the sympathetic branch of the carotid and forms the VDN nerve of the pterygoid canal. Now, at the level of the foramen lacerum, it runs anteriorly into this canal. See this? If you follow this nerve posteriorly, it will take you to the foramen lacerum.
Yeah.
From where the carotid artery emerges out. So, this is the most constant, to me, the most important landmark to the carotid artery, to find out the foramen lacerum part of the carotid artery, to find out the vertical or the paraclival part of the carotid artery. In times when you don't see the carotid artery very prominent, then you follow the median now, it will take you to the carotid artery. It will go straight up to the foramen lacerum towards the carotid, and just before the carotid, it turns laterally. Laterally, see the carotid, the horizontal petrous carotid comes like this, and at the foramen lacerum, this become vertical, okay?
Mm-hmm.
This comes like this, at foramen lacerum, this become vertical. This now goes posteriorly onto the foramen lacerum, and just before the carotid turns laterally, and cross the horizontal carotid. Got my point?
Yeah.
So this signifies the junction of the horizontal carotid towards the foramen lacerum carotid and towards the vertical carotid. So that is a very, very useful and important landmark. Fine?
Yeah.
Is it clear so far?
Very, very clear.
Now, we move on to the further. And audience, if you want to see anything in the pterygopalatine fossa here.
Is there anything else?
No, many things.
Internal maxillary artery, go towards the pterygomaxillary.
Okay, let me show you something. See laterally. Ashish,
yeah.
You have seen the now?
Yeah, very nice.
Now, lateral to this now, can you see some muscle coming into the view?
Yes.
What is this? Anybody in the audience? Which muscle is this? Okay, this is temporalis. This vertical muscle is temporalis muscle. Okay?
What?
Temporalis.
You are going to get the fascia?
Not. This is the vertical tendon going towards the coronary process.
Sorry, there are orientation is bigger. Temporal is there. Okay.
Now, this is the nerve. I am working both sides of the nerve.
Mm-hmm.
This is the V2.
V2, okay.
Continuing is infraorbital. Lateral to this, this is the temporalis. Okay? If I remove this part, this bone, and cut this temporalis, you will be in the infratemporal fossa, and I will show all the nerves, the V3, its various divisions of the V3, the auriculotemporal nerve, the
Satish, hold on. There's some. Just give a 2-minute break. You maybe have water or something. Vandana has to do something. Here.
Only water. Don't eat anything.
Just like a 2 or 3 minute break. Just
okay.
Just before you proceed.
Sir, you were asking about the greater palatine nerve.
Hello. Wait means wait. Hello.
Yes. Huh? You know,
Satish,
see,
is breaking.
This is the ganglion.
Thank you all of you all for coming here. I think you know what you're seeing.
What you're not seeing is for us to really be thankful about. I think this is what this is all about. We would really like to thank the 3 main people who have been so helpful and so wonderful behind what we get to see today. They are the people who have been helpful in getting us this fresh cadaver. I think people who have been helpful in getting us a scalpel of fresh cadaver, and believe me, that's an exercise. And there are people in our department, fraternity, ENT people in this institute who have been very helpful. So I think for me and from the entire team here, Medcon, Vandana, myself, Dr. Vaidya, entire team.
Okay, Satish, back to you.
So, by the way, Satish, you not been thanked, okay? No, just kidding. Okay, Satish, we are back.
Yes, dear.
Yeah. And of course, thanks to Medtronics and Karl Storz. I think thanks to them, really the quality of the image and the instrumentation.
Yeah, the image is amazing.
Fantastic. Yeah, there's no question.
No. Okay, Ashish.
Yeah.
We get back to where we left. Okay, so this was the artery.
Yeah.
Which I cut.
Yes.
This is the, see, for the juniors, this is the third part of the maxillary artery, which continues as spinopalatine artery.
Yeah.
This gives many branches. Here, what I have pulled out, one branch, important branch, after that, I'll show here. Can you see some branch going below?
Down, yeah, we can see.
Below?
Yeah,
here,
yeah,
down?
Yeah.
That is descending palatine artery. Can you see?
Yeah.
I will show after removal of the medial pterygoid plate, how it enters the palate. And after passing through the hard palate, it becomes the greater palatine artery. Before that, it is known as descending palatine artery. Can you see?
Very nicely, sir. Yeah.
Now, you have seen this V2.
Yeah.
This condensation, this thickening is the pterygopalatine ganglion.
Yeah.
Yep.
This gives the pharyngeal nerve, which we have cut here.
Yes.
And this nerve going below.
Yeah.
Can you see?
Yeah.
This is the greater palatine nerve. Okay?
Okay.
And one slender nerve, which probably we have cut with this artery, is the nasopalatine nerve. Okay? That is the only nerve which passes through the spinopalatine foramen, nasopalatine nerve. Okay? So, this is done. So, now we have the pterygoid process in exposure. Okay?
Yeah.
Perfect. Now, we move on behind. Now, we will move on to the infratemporal fossa and the parapharyngeal space. Very, very important structures in the parapharyngeal space and the nasopharynx. The relationship of the eustachian tube to the various structures.
Okay.
And then ultimately the parapharyngeal carotid artery. The carotid artery has 7 segments practically. Yes. The first segment is the cervical. See, this is the pharynx.
Yeah.
Ashish, this is eustachian tube.
Eustachian tube, yeah.
The carotid artery is within 1 centimeter lateral to it.
Okay.
Okay. That is parallel to the pharynx. That's why we call parapharyngeal portion of the carotid artery.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is basically the continuation of the first part, the cervical segment. That is cervical only, but known as parapharyngeal, and is runs in relation to the pharynx. Okay. Then it enters the carotid foramen in the temporal bone. If time permits, I'll show how it enters with the jugular vein, the carotid foramen and the jugular foramen and the 9th, 10th cranial, 11th cranial nerve through the nose, exiting the jugular foramen. So that all in the parapharyngeal space. Then it enters the temporal bone. There is first vertical part, the smaller segment, and the longer is the horizontal segment. Okay?
Yeah.
And then it comes out, the horizontal segment turns and forms the lacerum segment and the paraclival segment. And then the cavernous carotid starts, which has 4 portions, which I am going to show after dissecting all this bone. There is a lot of drilling required for that. So now, first of all, I am going to the nasopharynx and the pterygoid plate. See, this is the inferior turbinate we have removed.
Removed, yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
This is the mucosa.
Yeah.
This is the pterygoid plate, the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone.
Yes.
And behind, I am going to remove this mucosa.
Soft tissue, yeah. Okay.
To show you better. Is the picture still good?
Yeah.
See, I am.
Is this a good time to show the Haddad flap, or you want to proceed?
Okay, after this I will show the Haddad flap.
Yeah, okay.
Do I show first?
Whatever, I mean, whatever is in logically
okay.
in line.
Okay, yeah. That is a good idea to show you the Haddad flap first at this point so that we don't disrupt the vascularity. Okay. Now give me the forceps to remove all this. See, hard art flap is, as I mentioned, based on the posterior nasal branch of the sphenopalatine artery. Okay?
Yeah.
It's the most robust and the versatile flap to reconstruct the skull base, not only the anterior, middle, as well as the posterior skull base, and after the endoscopic surgery. It is very vascularized. You can modify the hard art flap, make it more broader. You can reconstruct a defect of up to 7 cm of the skull base with a hard art flap.
Okay, 7 cm.
Yes. See, I'll show how it extends. The only lacuna or the pitfall of the hard art flap is it has to be harvested even before the resection.
Yeah.
Ideally, once you resect the tumor, ascertain the defect,
yeah,
and then accordingly you raise the flap to reconstruct.
Correct.
But in the hard art flap, you can injure the pedicle during that part, so it has to be harvested before. So that is the only lacuna. Sometime it may fall short. So the best is to raise the widest possible hard art flap in the beginning.
Yeah.
Rather than
falling short later.
Falling short later. So, knife. We have seen the pedicle.
Yeah.
See, this is the sphenoid ostium.
Yeah.
This artery runs just below the sphenoid ostium. Ashish, you saw the bleeding from this artery in the morning.
Yes, yes.
This.
Yeah.
So make an incision, horizontal incision at the lower border of the ostium. Another horizontal incision at the upper border of the coina.
Okay.
So that will
preserve the artery.
This is the pedicle of this.
Yeah.
Containing the pedicle of this flap.
Yeah.
Now, this entire ipsilateral mucoperiosteum of the septum can be harvested up to above is leaving this olfactory epithelium. So don't go up behind the middle turbinate level.
Okay.
Leave this olfactory epithelium. Then you go up to the roof of the nasal cavity, coming anteriorly the mucocutaneous junction, or even if you want longer up to the columella. You can take this entire flap, come like this, then anteriorly go vertically down.
Yeah.
Then to make this flap broader, normally we take along the lower border of the septum, but you can make it better, broader, and take the entire floor of the nasal cavity.
Okay.
It depends upon the size of the defect or surgery you are doing. So the classical hard art flap, I will make my incision like this. See?
Yeah.
I am leaving the olfactory epithelium.
Yeah.
Up to the middle turbinate.
Okay.
And then I will turn up.
Yeah.
See this?
Yeah.
This anteriorly I am going up to the mucocutaneous junction.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Join this. It's very, very simple flap to elevate. And inferiorly, I will follow the inferior incision which I made posteriorly here. Okay?
Okay.
Along the lower border of the nasal septum. Like this. I could take a broader flap by taking the nasal floor as well. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, in the live surgical situation, it is much easier.
Yeah.
You just inject the saline, not the adrenaline.
Hydrodissection, yeah.
Hydrodissection. But here you can see how easily it comes out.
Yeah. Great.
See this?
Yeah.
Really, it is very, very simple flap. Scissors like Arvind. Scissors.
And then there is some hassle of parking it, right? Something which you were talking.
Parking this flap?
Yeah.
Yeah. We have two choices. Either
in the maxillary,
place it behind in the nasopharynx, behind the coina, and put a piece of merosel over it so it doesn't come in your instruments. Okay?
Yeah.
Or you can place it in the maxillary and trust maxillary sinus itself. See now.
Yeah.
Elevate this pedicle. Far laterally. Elevate this pedicle far laterally.
Elevate this pedicle far laterally. Okay.
Yes. The pedicle is within the flap. See, this flap is coming because we raised this for the demonstration of the draft. This is our Haggard forceps. See, this is our Haggard flap.
Yeah.
No. Knife. Mm. This cut was not good. काट नहीं रहा ना ये
सीज़र
कॉल काटता नहीं है यार
ठीक है थोड़ा ऊपर नीचे होता है समझ गए वी अंडरस्टूड
या सी द नाइफ हैज टू बी शार्प सो दैट यू डोंट
At the apex, do I see that first olfactory neuron coming
yeah,
up?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
See the important thing, Ashish.
Yeah.
The knife has to be sharp.
Yeah.
So that you cut in one go sharp.
You know, that's
yes.
why it's called number 15.
An important point from Dr. Major Sunil. You can use the cautery for the peripheral incision.
But it shrinks, no? It causes a few millimeters.
See, I am struggling as it was not a clean cut.
That's why they call it a number 15. It lasts only 15 seconds.
Yeah. See this?
Yeah.
Elevate this entire thing.
Okay. We got the point. Yeah. It's okay.
Got the idea?
Yeah, very well.
See now?
Yeah, now it is. Yeah.
See the pedicle here?
Yeah.
Pedicle here, elevate this pedicle far laterally.
Yeah.
So once you extend your sphenoidotomy down, or you do the caudal dissection, don't injure the flap. Okay?
Yeah.
Now either you place this flap in the this part is left. Yes. Now either you place in the nasopharynx or you place in the maxillary sinus like this. Okay? I am pushing it in the nasopharynx in this case. Okay? Fine? Scissors. Pardon? Okay, is it clear to everyone?
We are very, very well. Yeah. Thanks.
Like this.
Yeah, yeah. You
place it in the nasopharynx.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, another important point raised by Major Sunil again is what to do with this raw bony septum. Though, obviously, it is going to give lot of crusting. Ultimately, it is going to heal. Simply, what you can do, remove this posterior part of the nasal septum. See this. Okay? Remove this posterior part of the nasal septum. Bony nasal septum. This is the opposite mucoperichondrial flap coming into the view. Can you see? Hello?
Yes, yes.
This is the opposite mucoperichondrial flap.
Right.
Now, that is the rostrum. You make a vertical incision here.
Yep.
Horizontal, two upper and lower horizontal incision and take this flap back on this raw area anteriorly. So that is known as reverse flap.
Yep.
To minimize the raw area, leaving the septectomy opening behind. Okay?
Fine.
Now, see, as I mentioned earlier, this is the Eustachian tube.
Yeah.
And anterior to the Eustachian tube, this is the medial pterygoid plate. Can you see?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is the pterygoid process. See, from above. This is the pterygoid process.
Yes.
And here is the medial pterygoid plate.
Right.
Now, if I raise this mucoperiosteum, see carefully.
Yeah.
What comes next?
The Eustachian
tube. If I raise this mucoperiosteum, only mucoperiosteum.
Yeah.
Will come across the first structure, the muscle known levator. As levator valley palatini.
Oh.
I'll show.
Okay.
That is behind. See this?
Yeah.
Can you see this Eustachian tube?
Yeah.
Yes.
This is the Eustachian tube?
Yes.
This is the Eustachian tube, cartilaginous, and can you see this muscle?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you see this
muscle?
Yeah,
very well. Yeah.
That is levator valley palatini. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah. That it turns around down, lower down.
The pterygoid is lower down.
And then see, this is the soft palate. This is the soft palate.
Right.
So it turns medially around the pterygoid hamulus and joins the opposite muscle, opposite levator palatini muscle. Can you see this?
Right. Yeah.
So this is Eustachian tube. See the relationship. It runs in the floor of the Eustachian tube. The anterior wall goes behind. This is a very, very important landmark for the parapharyngeal carotid artery. We'll see once we resect this muscle and the Eustachian tube, we'll be right on the parapharyngeal carotid artery. This step, why I'm showing this dissection? This is the classical nasopharyngectomy. What we do in nasopharyngectomy and when it is indicated in nasopharyngeal carcinoma, we know majority are radiosensitive. But the other tumors of the nasopharynx, like if somebody has a melanoma, somebody has an adenocarcinoma, somebody has an adenoid cystic carcinoma, which are not radiosensitive, then what is the option? If it is limited, not involve the skull base extensively, simply is to do a nasopharyngectomy. And the limit of the nasopharyngectomy here comes. We need to define the carotid artery laterally. We need to resect the Eustachian tube, levator palatini. I'm going to drill this medial pterygoid plate, going to show you the tensor palatini. Take these muscle, go around the tensor palatini, go around the Eustachian tube, go around the longus muscle, and same thing you do on the opposite side. And the end cuff and block removal of all these structures is known as nasopharyngectomy. This is indicated for the nasopharyngeal carcinoma, which are residual or recurrent after the radiation therapy. So that is the only treatment for all these malignancies in this region. So give me the drill now. See, this is the medial pterygoid plate. We have seen the levator palatini.
Yeah.
I'm going to drill that medial pterygoid now. And then you go there, cutting the time like I guess. And show you, give me the tensor tympani. And lateral to the medial pterygoid, lateral to the medial pterygoid plate, and lateral to the tensor tympani is going to come the medial pterygoid muscle. I'll show that. See, this is the pterygoid process.
Yeah.
Again, the V2 and the median canals.
Yes, very nice.
And below, dividing into two processes, this medial one.
Yeah.
Arbodo, cutting to karo. This is the medial pterygoid plate, okay? This is a thin plate of bone. In live surgical situation, this has to be done with a diamond drill. That here, to save the time, problem hai pani wani aane mein isme. Chalo, suction de. This is to be done with the diamond drill. Okay? Now, give me the section. Give me this instrument only. Hello?
Yeah, yeah.
You have seen the levator pellet in I?
Yes, here? We saw it. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
I am removing this pterygoid plate, thin plate. See this, how thin it is?
Yeah.
The next vertical muscle in order, here, this is tensor palatini muscle. This vertical muscle here.
Okay.
This is tensor palatini. I will clear it. Remove this bone, boss. Give me the drill. I will show another important vessel, the structure. I am going to remove this entire bone from anterior to posterior. Aray, pani nahi aa raha. Pani, upar se dal do yaar. Upar se phenk. Much of irrigation, too much of irrigation. Come, kar yaar. This one.
Yes, yeah, we can see, yeah.
That is medial pterygoid. That is lateral to the tensor palati.
Tensor palati, okay.
This is tensor palati.
Yeah.
In our nasopharyngectomy,
yeah,
our limit is the tensor palati, the lateral limit.
Okay.
We go lateral to the plane of this tensor palati.
Okay.
See, you go behind, there is a good plane.
Yeah.
Can you see?
Very nice.
This,
yeah.
All this thick muscle is medial pterygoid.
Okay.
Above the medial pterygoid, here, this is the pterygoid process. If I remove this bone, which I am going to remove later, if I remove this bone, drill the pterygoid process. Okay?
Yeah.
Remove this bone. Retract this V2, you can see the glimpse of.
Yeah.
Here is the lateral pterygoid.
Oh, yeah.
Lateral pterygoid has two heads, the upper and lower. Upper one arises from the greater wing of sphenoid. See the direction of fibers going upwards and laterally.
Okay.
There are two heads of the lateral pterygoid. And these insert on the neck of the mandible. If I remove this pterygoid process and this bone completely, this pterygopalatine fossa bone, will be seeing the inner margin of the mandible here.
Okay.
The medial pterygoid, from the medial pterygoid plate, it goes to the angle of the mandible, the medial surface of the angle of mandible like this.
Okay.
It runs like this. And the lateral pterygoid runs like this. Okay?
Okay.
From the pterygoid plates. And if we remove the lateral pterygoid muscle, we'll see all the nerves in the infratemporal fossa. So sooner we are going to see that. Lot of bone removal is required for that. So this is the tensor palati.
Yeah.
This is the levator palati.
Yeah, okay.
Now give me the debrider.
Blade.
If we resect the Eustachian tube following these muscles. Where's the pedal? Yes. Hello.
Yes, Satish.
I am debriding the portion of the Eustachian, this mucosa.
Yeah. So it doesn't come in the way of drilling.
To make the anatomy more clearer. These muscles. See the levator muscle.
Yeah.
This levator muscle corresponds to the carotid artery behind directly. I will show.
Corresponds.
I'm dividing this tissue
to
make it more clear. In the live surgical situation, one surgeon pulls and retracts this Eustachian tube medially, more and more medially like this. I'll show. hold the eustachian tube and retract it inferiorly and medially like this, and the other surgeon going around this muscle and the eustachian tube, if we cut this, we'll come to the carotid artery behind. So the only concern in this surgery is the carotid artery, and for which the navigation system is of immense help.
Oh, okay.
There comes the value. See the levator palati going?
Yeah, yeah. Very nice.
Laterally up. This goes up and insert on the bony eustachian tube. What we are seeing is the cartilaginous.
Okay.
If we follow this eustachian tube and these muscles will go up to the bony eustachian tube. Okay? See laterally?
Yeah.
वो कहाँ गया? दूसरा एंड. हाँ, ये तो. See now. This is your eustachian tube, cartilaginous eustachian tube.
Yeah.
This is levator palatini muscle.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
Is it clear?
Yeah.
Yep.
Now. Now, divider. In live surgical situation, between the levator and the tensor palati, we come across a venous plexus.
Is just what I was going to ask you. In the live situation, you get a lot of oozing here.
Just push your surgery flow for a while, pack with a gauze pack and remove that, and the bleeding stops immediately. See now, we have access more laterally. Arre, suction chalu nahi hai boss, kaun sa chalu hai? Where is the other section? Yeah. Chalu hai? Chalu hi rakh do yaar. See now. We are moving far laterally.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And this is the cartilage of the eustachian tube. Okay?
Yeah.
We need to drill this bone a little bit. Get more access. In skull-based surgery, like the transodontoid here, through the odontoid process, eustachian tube to eustachian tube is our limit. If you stay medial to the eustachian tube, your carotid artery is automatically protected. So we'll see how the eustachian tube has a relationship with the carotid artery. Drill, drill. I'll drill a little bit and show you clearly how the eustachian tube goes up and all these muscles. So we'll resect this at the same time, preserving the carotid artery. अरे बॉस का ड्रिल चालू कराओ ना.
ड्रिल चालू.
मेट्रोनिक. ये लो, हो गया. पानी कम कर दो यार इसका. I am just removing a little bit more of this bone. In skull based surgery, one should not attempt to remove the structures unless you remove the bone and expose the area completely. Suction. Give me the suction, please. Suction nahi chal raha. Hello?
Yeah, Satish.
Scissors. Give me the scissors. I will cut this portion of the cartilaginous eustachian tube.
Yeah.
Staying only on the eustachian tube. Ball probe? Hai ball probe?
Yes.
Nahi hai. I will use the curette then. No ball probe. I want to retract this muscle medially. Here ball probe is the best instrument. Since we do not have ball probe.
Hello.
Yes, dear.
Yeah, yeah. I thought we lost the sound.
Ashish.
Yeah.
It takes 5 minutes here.
Yeah.
To dissect so that I can show you the structures in a better way.
Yeah, yeah. Take your time.
You need certain specific instruments in this area.
Yeah.
See the pad of fat.
Yeah.
No, scissors. We have cut the upper portion of the eustachian tube.
Yeah.
And now I am cutting the lower portion of this muscle.
Levator, no?
Levator.
Levator.
Yeah.
The scissors is not going. No, the brighter doesn't me. काटी नहीं है बस. चलो एक बार डिब्राइडर दे दो फिर देखते हैं. सी आई हैव कट द लिवेटर. कैन यू सी?
या
लोअर एंड ऑफ द लिवेटर. एंड नाउ चालू तो करो सक्शन. सक्शन बॉस. I am taking the levator with the debrider. There is no way. See where the fossa of Rosenmüller is?
Yes.
Behind the eustachian tube?
Yeah.
This is a deep fossa of Rosenmüller. That's a favorable sign for the skull base surgery. More deeper it is, farther are the carotid arteries.
Yeah, I can.
For it is a negative influence for the dissection, because farther the carotid,
more
dissection is required.
Yeah.
Suction kamzor hai yaar. Suction.
Thak gaya. Blade naya nikalo.
ब्लेड नहीं काट रही ना.
सक्शन मेरे हिसाब से जरा.
हेलो.
या
यस डियर.
अभी किधर है क्या है बोल जरा. घूम गए हम लोग.
या जस्ट आई एम जस्ट रिट्रैक्टिंग दिस मसल.
हाँ.
सी फॉर योर ओरिएंटेशन.
या
दिस इज द नेसोफेरिंक्स.
या
दिस इज द यूस्टेकियन ट्यूब.
या
if you go behind the eustachian tube, see the foramen of fossa of Rosenmüller.
Yes.
This is the tip of the fossa of Rosenmüller.
Yeah.
This is another guide.
Okay.
See where the tip of the fossa of Rosenmüller is.
Yeah.
The levator palatine muscle is going.
Going, yeah.
बंद हो गया बस. कैन यू सी द सम वेसल हियर रनिंग अप. स्मॉल वेसल.
यस समथिंग वेरी स्मॉल.
यस दीज आर द ब्रांचेस ऑफ असेंडिंग फेरिंजियल आर्टरी.
Okay.
They run in close proximity of the to the carotid artery. Behind this would be the carotid artery. See, I don't have an angle instrument. I will show where would the carotid be. This is the branches of ascending pharyngeal. Hello?
Yeah, yeah, we can see.
Behind this fat, there is lot of vessels here, venous plexus here. And behind this would be...
Yes, cervical carotid, you said, right?
Yeah, parapharyngeal.
Parapharyngeal, yeah, it's the cervical but in the par.
Yeah, this fat is the plane. And just onto the carotid will be the styloid complex muscles. The styloid complex muscle, the stylopharyngeus muscle, crosses the carotid here. I will remove this. My carotid is coming into the picture now. Hello?
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Can you see this vertical vessel?
Right. Yeah.
I will make it more clearer. It is. I need some instrument to tease out this fact. The sickle is not going there. See boss, can you see this vessel?
Yeah, yeah.
Can you
make beautiful, out? Beautiful.
This vertical vessel, I'll make it more clearer. Give me some instrument, Gaurav. Long instrument. No. Okay. Haan, ye de de. Usko connect kar, this section se. That is the carotid artery here.
We can see now.
Not like this. Oh ho. Nahi pahunch raha hai instrument, my dear. See Ashish.
Yeah.
I asked the stores guy,
yeah,
he'll bring the skull base set. He really need longer instruments. Give me any long instrument. Any long. See the carotid wall.
Very nice.
Very well.
If you go further lateral to it, you'll see the jugular. If you remove this, we'll remove this pterygoid process to go directly onto it, like we did the see laterally initially.
Yeah, yeah.
We'll remove this pre-lacrimal, use this pre-lacrimal approach to access this.
Yeah.
Now, if you remove this pterygoid process along with the lateral and the medial pterygoid muscles, we'll go directly onto the parapharyngeal space, the carotid, jugular, all the cranial nerves here. Okay.
Okay.
See, this is behind this long instrument. कोई अन्य उसमें है क्या अपने में कोई?
He said surgery flow. Oh yeah, that's what he said. Yeah.
See, hello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My instruments are falling short here. Really need a long skull base instruments here.
Yeah.
But we'll get something. I want to tell this relationship of the carotid artery. See, in adenoid surgery or anything you do in nasopharynx, majority of the time you see the pulsations. But see, how far is the carotid? Those are the transmitted pulsations. See, this was the Eustachian tube and this was the fossa of Rosenmüller. The tip of the fossa is here.
Yeah.
And just behind is the carotid here.
Yeah.
Now, let us remove this bone fast, show you the lateral pterygoid, the V3 and the cauda tympani and the other nerves. Give me the drill, fast. But that will be the infratemporal fossa dissection. Is it clear?
Very nice, Satish.
Once I get this access from here, probably our regular instruments will be able to use them. Yeah. हाँ ड्रिल चाहिए मेरे को फास्ट। नॉट कटिंग यार क्या चक्कर है, क्या दे दिया ही? नॉट कटिंग, पानी हट गया। नॉट कटिंग, गिव मी द गाउज एंड हैमर, गिव मी द गाउज एंड हैमर, डजंट मैटर हैमर गाउज। हेलो हेलो,
या 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 सर, यू राइट
आशीष,
या
दे आर डूइंग समथिंग विद द ड्रिल, सो आई एम यूजिंग द गाउज एंड हैमर।
या या
Yeah. Yes. Say this.
Very good, Amol. Good job.
That is not Amol.
That is not Amol. That is Arvind. Very good.
This is not the forceps, yeah. क्या कर रहा है अरविंद? Forceps straight, straight black slee. क्या हुआ? Straight black slee. Yes. See the V2 going into the foramen rotundum, and this is the pterygoid process. See the axis now. Hello.
Yeah, yeah, Satish.
Now, if I tease out this fat, see the muscle.
Yeah.
This is lateral pterygoid.
Yeah. Lateral pterygoid.
Yes.
Okay.
Once you remove the lateral pterygoid, lots of nerves coming into the are going to come into the picture. Can you see one of those?
Yeah. Yeah.
Between the medial pterygoid below and the lateral pterygoid, I'll tease out this fat completely. एक बार ये और देते गाउज हैमर, काम करते हैं इसका पूरा।
Christmas is
Yes. यस, एक और लगाओ ऊपर ठोक। यस, सी द टेरिगोइड प्रोसेस। रुक जा रुक जा, और अमोल में दम है यार।
हाँ, न्यू टेक्निक डेवलप किया तुमने,
सी
द मेंटकॉन टेक्निक
यूजिंग द गाउज एंड हैमर फॉर ऑल दिस। See now, this is the pterygoid muscle complex now.
Okay.
The medial and the lateral pterygoids.
Yeah.
See, these are the muscles. And I am going to remove all these muscles to go right to the skull base. There, debrider, there.
So our friend Dr. Dubey from Bhopal asked, when you get a Dr. Dubey from Bhopal, he's asking, when you get a trismus, it means these muscles are invaded by the tumor. That's when you get the trismus.
Trismus, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. See, these are the muscles which are responsible for the jaw movement.
Yeah.
The medial and lateral pterygoids and the temporalis and the masseter.
Yeah.
If these muscles are involved, definitely it will affect the movement of the jaw. Yes, now the
guys among Sanjay, may I comment? Satish is going to show this at our Indore
Hello?
Course. Yeah.
See, these are the muscles of the mastication, the jaw movements. If these are affected, obviously there will be, that will affect the movement of the jaw, leading to the trismus.
Yeah.
I am taking away all these branches of the maxillary artery. Okay?
Yeah.
See the muscles?
Yeah.
Once I remove these muscles, see, I can palpate the mandible here.
Okay. Pahunch gaya mandible tak.
Yeah.
I wonder what Sandesh has to say.
Yeah, this is continuation of the maxillary artery. See, this entire infratemporal fossa is full of these muscles, branches of the maxillary artery, and behind the branches of the mandibular nerve.
What about the oozing here in the live patient? In the live patient, kitna bleeding ho gaya hai?
Hota hai. You just keep using the surgery flow in between.
Kitna batli?
Just 2 ml, 1 or 2 ml. Yeah, the nerve coming into the view, I will show. Can you see some nerve coming into the view?
Yeah.
The most medial one is the lingual nerve.
Lingual nerve?
Yeah. To explain,
yeah,
we need to understand the branches of the mandibular nerve. I will enumerate in a minute.
Yeah.
Mandibular nerve comes out of the foramen ovale.
Uh-huh.
The trunk of the mandibular nerve gives one branch, that is nerve to medial pterygoid.
Nerve to medial.
And that branch from the trunk, nerve to medial pterygoid, supplies two other muscles besides the medial pterygoid, the tensor and levator palatini, from the trunk, and that is through the branch to medial pterygoid. Okay?
Okay.
Hello?
Yeah.
Then it divides into two major divisions. The anterior division supply all these muscles. The mesenteric branch, the branch to temporalis, branch to lateral pterygoid, okay, and the buccal nerve. All these branches come from the anterior division. Then the posterior division, sickle though. Can you see the two nerves coming into the view?
Yeah.
The medial one is the lingual nerve, the lateral one is the inferior alveolar nerve, which is going to go into the canal of the mandible laterally. See?
Yeah.
So the posterior division divides into three branches. The first one is the auricular temporal nerve, which goes laterally immediately. And the other two are the lingual nerve and the inferior alveolar nerves. Okay?
Yeah.
See carefully, is Dr. Tarabichi there?
Yes, he's there. He's holding his head with his hand.
So I'm going to show him the chorda tympani now.
What?
See the two branches of the posterior division of mandibular nerve.
Now he's asking you where the sciatic nerve is going to come.
Where the?
Sciatic nerve. इधर तक पहुंच गया तो पूरा अभी
sciatic nerve.
Sciatic nerve.
See, there are three branches of the posterior division of the mandibular nerve.
Yeah.
One is the auricular temporal nerve, which it is given off here superiorly,
uh-huh,
and turns laterally and form the otic ganglion to supply the parotid gland. Okay.
Okay.
And the other two branches we see here.
Yeah.
This is the lingual nerve, okay, and this is the inferior alveolar nerve. Okay?
Okay.
If we trace it above, it will go to the posterior division. This main trunk is less than a centimeter after exiting the foramen ovale, divides into two divisions, and then it divides into multiple branches.
This is just for those interested. You will see Satish Jain again in action doing something like this, and probably even more, maybe the lateral, at the Indore event which Dr. Sanjay Agarwal and Dr. Dubey are going to organize, and we are the part of that event. April 4th, 5th and 6th. There's going to be
Satish.
Yeah. We are watching.
See the important thing I want to show.
Yeah.
The foramen ovale.
Yeah, superb.
Okay. Now see, the V2, this is V2, again a branch of trigeminal.
Yes.
You have preserved this V2.
Yeah.
So here at this level, behind the cavernous sinus, here is the trigeminal ganglion. I will show that ganglion.
Okay.
The Michael's cave and the ganglion in the dissection now after this. That results into three branches and they disperse out in different direction. See, the ganglion is here.
Okay.
The first branch V1, it goes up. like this in the superior orbital fissure. Okay.
Okay.
See, this is the optic canal.
Yeah.
Just anterior and inferior to it is the superior orbital fissure. Okay. So V1 enters the superior orbital fissure superiorly.
Okay.
V2 goes horizontally laterally into the foramen rotundum.
Yeah.
And V3 goes downwards and laterally.
Okay. Yeah.
So V2, V3,
yeah.
And we'll dissect very soon the V1.
Okay.
So this is V3.
Yeah.
See now how it comes.
Beautiful.
It's the thickest of all the three nerves.
Yeah.
It comes out of the foramen ovale. Here is the foramen ovale.
Yeah.
Can you see?
Yeah.
See, this less than 1 centimeter is the trunk of the mandibular. Then this is the anterior division going. See this?
We can see very clearly. Yeah.
Now this is the posterior division, which results into three branches. The upper branch, see, going horizontally here. This horizontally and posteriorly. This one here is the auricular temporal nerve. I will dissect a little bit more. And two lower branches. This one is inferior alveolar nerve, and this is the lingual nerve. Chorda tympani joins which nerve? Just see how it joins. See, again, before showing that, this foramen ovale. See? Can you see this structure? What is this projection? What is this?
No idea.
Spine of sphenoid.
Spine of sphenoid.
Sphenoid.
Okay.
Okay. The chorda tympani, after leaving the petrotympanic fissure, runs medial to the spine of sphenoid, comes behind the inferior alveolar nerve. My sickle is not working here. I will show how it joins the lingual now. Can you give some longer dissecting from ball probers? Give me this. I think this will work. I want to split this fat. It comes from behind and joins the lingual from behind. That relationship I want to show. My instrument is not going beyond this. Just a moment, please.
Yeah.
This is a knife. Can you see the nerve?
Yes.
Can you see the
Yes.
This is
fantastic.
Chorda tympani joining the lingual nerve. See?
Oh man. Okay.
See, this is a thin nerve, small nerve.
Yeah. Tarabichi is convinced or not? Arvind Patil wants to know.
See, this is the thin nerve coming from behind.
Yeah.
And joining the lingual nerve.
Yeah.
Let me make it more clearer.
Huh? Yeah.
Okay. So that is lingual nerve. You see clearly now.
Yeah.
See, that is the lingual nerve.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now, the another important thing, see Ashish, if you go in the lateral skull based surgery, if you remember the type C infratemporal fossa approach.
Yes.
Fish type 3, Dr. Ashim there?
Yeah, Ashim
right here.
Boss?
Yeah.
See the lingual nerve.
Perfect.
In type C approach, when we dislocate the mandibular condyle, the carotid arteries cross by various structures. You know, if you go back to that area. First, it is crossed by the middle meningeal artery.
Yeah.
Right.
See?
Yes.
We debrided the branches of the maxillary artery here.
Yes.
The middle meningeal arises from the second part of the this thing, maxillary artery goes up here, goes up here and crosses the carotid artery.
Correct.
Okay?
Yeah.
There we cauterize that vessel.
Yes.
Then comes next the V3. So here is the V3.
Oval.
Yeah. Which crosses the carotid artery. So
yes.
Here is the V3 and this is the carotid artery behind.
Yes.
See?
Yes.
I don't have a longer instrument. If you dissect it superiorly, this is the cut end of the levator.
Yeah.
Levator palatini muscle. Can you see this cut end?
Yes. Yes.
So this directly lies over the carotid artery. This is the carotid artery here.
Yeah.
This bluish structure.
Yes. Yeah, we can see.
This very vascular structure.
Very clearly. Yeah.
So this lies directly over the carotid artery.
Yeah.
And here is the bony eustachian tube where it is arising from.
Right.
So in the infratemporal fossa type C approach,
yes,
we see three structures crossing the carotid artery. Yeah. The middle meningeal artery. It is here,
V3,
lateral to this V3,
foramen oval, yeah.
Then V3,
yes,
and then is the eustachian tube.
Right.
We see in the middle ear, eustachian tube runs lateral to the carotid artery.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yes.
So here it is the bony eustachian tube here, and this is the cartilaginous eustachian tube.
Right.
And here is the levator palatini muscle arising from the bony eustachian tube and crossing the carotid artery. This is the carotid artery.
Yeah,
got it.
Very
now,
well.
If we cut this V3 here and go further laterally, if you cut this and go further laterally,
yeah, you're seeing,
we'll see the jugular vein.
Yes.
Okay.
See, we can see the glimpse of the jugular. Can you see?
Yeah.
This blue is jugular. The jugular is here. The carotid is here. If we cut this V3, we'll see the jugular foramen and the nerves coming out of that 9, 10, 11, which we generally see in the infratemporal fossa type A approach.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
So, many people in the world have now started doing these paragangliomas or vagal neuromas, which are mostly extra temporal bone, outside the temporal bone, endoscopically,
approach,
without any external incision, through this approach. But with this approach, the disadvantage is you have to sacrifice the branches of the trigeminal nerves. That is the biggest problem with that. But sometimes these neuromas have already paralyzed the nerves, and then certainly this is a very good approach. See, now this I am going, see, this is probably the 10th nerve here. Can you see the vagus?
Yes.
Can you see this vagus now?
We can see some nerve.
We can see some nerve.
You have to tell us what
see,
it is.
See, I have to cut this. This is the jugular.
Yeah.
This is the jugular.
Yeah.
This is the carotid here.
Yeah.
See, my carotid is here.
Right.
Jugular is here.
Yes.
And in between are the cranial nerves, and that is one of them. This is in between and behind is the vagus now. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, the question arises, where does the hypoglossal nerve comes from? It doesn't come out of the jugular foramen, but lies in close relationship to the 9th, 10th, 11th. Okay?
Yes.
Now, can you see this group of muscles?
Yeah.
This is the carotid artery.
Yeah.
We have divided some muscles anterior to it.
Yeah.
This is the group of muscles anterior to the carotid artery here. This muscle. These are the styloid complex muscles. See, these are coming from above. If you follow these, here is roughly the styloid process. Okay?
Okay.
I can feel this bony process. Can you see my movements here?
Yeah, we can.
This is the styloid process. See clearly?
Yeah, we can see.
This is the styloid process. From these muscles are coming down.
Yeah.
So they cross the internal carotid artery. If you see in the infratemporal fossa type A approach, you have to resect the styloid process along with muscles to find the carotid artery medial to that.
Yeah.
So this is how this parapharyngeal space is divided by this styloid process in the pre-styloid and the post-styloid compartments. Can you see?
Yes.
So, which one is more important? Post-styloid compartment, as it contains all these neurovascular structures. See, behind the styloid process, here, this is the styloid process.
Endoscopic picture.
Behind
endoscopic
is the carotid artery. Endoscopic picture, please.
Endoscopic picture.
Endoscopic picture. Change over.
Wait,
see this thick
okay,
bone.
Got it.
Can you see this thick bone?
Yes.
The styloid process and the muscles coming out of it.
Yeah.
The medial most, this muscle left, the medial most left is the stylopharyngeus.
Yes.
Okay?
Yeah.
Life physical situation, you need to have a navigation for the carotid artery, only for the carotid artery, nothing else. See now, the important relationship, this is a styloid process,
yep.
Stylopharyngeus muscle crossing the carotid here, this is the carotid artery, 9th, 10th, 11th muscle nerves are here between the carotid and the jugular here. Okay?
Okay.
And where is the 12th nerve? See, as this carotid artery above enters the temporal bone here.
Yeah.
Okay? At the carotid foramen. Just after exiting the carotid foramen, this artery, the first structure which crosses this artery is the glossopharyngeal nerve.
Yeah.
It is high up. See, I am higher up at the skull base level where the carotid foramen is. Here, roughly here. Here is the mandibular canal okay. in the skull base. And here is the carotid canal. Okay?
Yep.
And behind this carotid artery, see, if I resect this carotid artery, if I have a longer instrument, I could retract it laterally and show you the hypoglossal nerve coming out of the hypoglossal canal behind the carotid artery. Got my point?
Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, yeah, got it. Yeah.
This is the carotid. If I dissect it and retract it laterally, I would see the hypoglossal nerve coming out of the hypoglossal canal. Okay?
Okay.
So this comes out of the hypoglossal canal behind the carotid artery and takes a lateral turn here and comes out with the 9th, 10th, 11th nerve and then again comes lateral to the carotid and comes medially. Okay? In the okay. submandibular fossa. Okay?
Okay, perfect.
So this is the styloid process.
Yeah.
So now to relate this hypoglossal foramen, hypoglossal canal, see, this is your sphenoid. Okay? Once you remove the floor of the sphenoid, I am going to remove this floor of the sphenoid and remove the clivus. Behind will be the pons and the medulla oblongata and laterally in the lower part would be the hypoglossal canal here which leads the hypoglossal nerve which exits the hypoglossal canal, comes behind the carotid artery and then goes along with the 9th and 11th nerve. Is this anatomy clear in this
yeah,
region?
Yeah. Very nice, Satish.
Any questions so that we move on to the another part?
Yeah, no questions.
Okay?
Yeah.
Fine. So now we move on to the?
What part?
First we can show the orbital decompression. See
yeah.
this? This lamina papyracea. Can you see this?
Yeah, very well.
I am removing this lamina. See this thick bone?
Yeah.
Behind. This is optic tubercle. We call it optic tubercle inferiorly. See this thick bone?
Yeah.
See, this is the orbit. Okay? Hello?
Yeah, yeah.
Ashish?
Yeah, yeah. It's
in the morning, you are discussing
case.
About
yeah.
the biopsy for that case.
Yeah, yeah.
Ashish?
Yes.
You are discussing about
yeah,
biopsy
about
from the orbit
yeah.
in that case.
Yeah.
Where to enter into the orbit from? Mm. See, here is the medial rectus muscle.
Yeah.
Inferiorly would be the inferior rectus muscle.
Yeah.
And you get a very good corridor between the inferior and the medial rectus muscle.
Okay.
Through which you enter the orbit without damaging anything.
Okay.
You can go up to the optic now and remove the lesions, all the lesions medial to the optic now. Can you see this?
Very nicely, yeah.
This is the limit of my inferior rectus muscle.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
Then the fat pad and medially here is the medial rectus muscle.
So between the two you do?
Yeah. See the medial rectus muscle?
Yes.
See this?
Yeah.
I am going the showing the things fast.
Yeah. yeah.
Because there are 50. So many things to demonstrate. This dissection.
How much time more Satish you would like?
For me you have to say I may take if you allow me.
He'll go on till 12 o'clock.
10 hours I can show you all the cranial nerves. So it's up to you. That's why I'm showing you fast, because we have time limit.
Yeah.
So this is the medial rectus muscle.
Mm-hmm.
Can you see this?
Yeah, very nice.
This is the lamina papyracea.
Yeah.
You remove the lamina papyracea like this. See the medial rectus muscle. Here is the inferior rectus muscle. Okay?
Yeah.
And see the nerves passing through this. This is the continuation of the nasociliary nerve. This is the branch of V1.
Nasociliary nerve.
Yes. See, we'll go behind to the cavernous sinus, superior orbital fissure. Through the superior orbital fissure, there are four nerves which enter the orbit. The third, fourth, sixth, and the V1. And their branches, how they branch inside the orbit. I'll show this dissection fast. Theoretically, the third nerve, the oculomotor nerve, divides into two branches, two divisions, and supply the inferior rectus, medial rectus, superior rectus, not the lateral rectus, and the inferior oblique muscles, four muscles. Fourth nerve supplies the superior oblique, and the sixth supplies the lateral rectus. So the oculomotor divides into two divisions, supplies these four extraocular muscles and two intrinsic muscles, the ciliaris and the constrictor pupillae. Similarly, the V1, see now where I am working. See, this is the optic now.
Yeah.
Can you see?
Yeah, very nice.
I am working at the orbital apex, removing this bone.
That's the annulus of Zinn, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Here, all these tendineous muscle come to one point and make the tendon of Zinn. Annulus of Zinn. Now, so third, fourth, sixth, beside that, the V1 enters the superior orbital fissure. This V1, this is the optic nerve. See?
Yeah.
I am showing the optic nerve decompression fast.
Yeah.
See? Remove this. If the bone is thin, you can remove the periosteum. The important structure comes here is the ophthalmic artery in relation to the optic nerve. Ophthalmic artery is the first branch of the intracranial portion of the carotid. See now?
Yes. Superiorly, yeah.
Can you see the ophthalmic artery? Can you see the optic along with the nerve?
Yeah.
Yes.
You have 10 minutes to show.
Just. Oh my God. Can we extend a little bit to show the sphenoidal anatomy, the carotid anatomy? See this, Ashish?
Yeah.
This is the optic nerve.
Yeah.
And superolaterally comes the ophthalmic artery. So while incising the optic nerve sheath, this is very important, and MRI tells you very clearly. So before, sometimes it is variable. It may come inferomedially.
You
can't injure the ophthalmic artery, otherwise the patient will become blind. So before any optic decompression, it is imperative to get an MRI done to see the location of the ophthalmic artery. So now, this is the optic nerve. Okay?
Yeah.
This is the carotid artery.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah, can see it.
This is the optico-carotid recess.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, this carotid artery is the cavernous carotid.
Right.
See, and this optico-carotid recess is formed by the optic struct. See this? I am removing this bone, optic struct.
Yeah.
This separates the optic nerve above, see the optic nerve above?
Yeah.
To the superior orbital fissure below.
Yeah.
Optic nerve to the superior.
Can you see?
Yes.
This is your carotid artery.
Yeah.
In the cavernous sinus, I am separating this. Medially.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
And this laterally is the orbital apex, and this is the superior orbital fissure.
Yes.
Can you see?
Very well, sir.
I am in the cavernous sinus.
Yeah.
I am going fast, boss. I have only 10 minutes. See, this is the cavernous portion of the carotid artery. See?
Yeah.
Clear?
Very well, see. Yeah.
Here is the cella tarsica, medial to the carotid. This is the cella.
Yeah.
See? This is the cella. This is the cella.
Yeah.
Right.
This is the normal cella here, the yellowish structure. See in the floor of the cella. Can you see?
Yeah.
Very well.
Now, see the carotid artery, course of the carotid artery. the cavernous carotid. See, this is the horizontal cavernous carotid.
Yes.
Can you see?
Yeah.
Going behind. Can you see the vessel arising from the carotid?
Wonderful. Yeah.
This is what? Inferior hypophyseal artery. Can you see? This is the carotid. This is forming the dome here.
Yes.
The anterior genu.
Yeah.
This is the horizontal course. There it forms the posterior genu behind. I will show this first. Bones, the same periosteum or a diamond drill. If the sphenoid is pneumatized, everything comes out with the periosteum elevator if you are working in the correct plane. Go there. Go the mirror. Yeah. See the course of the carotid artery. Is it visible?
Very, very visible.
Very clearly.
See this. Can you see this vessel? How it is coming from?
Yes.
There are two branches of the carotid artery from this area.
Yeah.
From the posterior genu, here is the posterior genu, is the meningohypophyseal trunk from which this inferior hypophyseal artery is coming.
Okay.
See?
Yeah.
And here is the carotid, this thing, cella.
Cella.
This is my pituitary gland. Can you see this pituitary gland?
Very well.
This is pituitary.
Yeah.
So once we are doing pituitary surgery, you see how the carotid is in the lateral relation.
Yeah.
In the cavernous. Okay?
Yeah.
And which portion of the carotid is at stake? Which portion? This horizontal cavernous portion.
Yeah.
This horizontal cavernous portion. Superior lateral, this compartment is absolutely free. This is the safest compartment. So this is the inferior hypophyseal artery.
Yeah.
Now behind the cella, this is the dorsum cella. Can you see?
Yes.
I am removing this dorsal cella. This is the posterior clinoid process. See this?
Right.
This is the posterior clinoid. I am removing this posterior clinoid of this side.
Okay.
Suction. Fast.
थोड़ा चलता है, 15 मिनट चलता है. It's okay.
I have broken the posterior clinoid. This is the posterior clinoid.
Yeah.
And see behind, this is dura. If I cut this dura, we'll be seeing the upper part of the basilar artery.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
This behind this dura is the basilar artery.
And then behind this dura,
see, I have opened the dura. Can you see the vessel behind?
Yeah.
See the prominent basilar artery.
Yeah.
Can you see?
Very well.
This is behind the dorsum cella. Ashish.
Yeah.
Can I have 15 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. See the upper part of the basilar artery.
Yes.
अरे बाप रे अभी किधर गया तू बॉस.
See dividing into what?
Okay.
See dividing into what? This is the superior cerebellar artery.
Yes.
Okay. And two terminal branches, the posterior cerebellar artery, cerebral arteries. Can you see?
Yes.
And in between these two is the third nerve.
Oh yes, fantastic.
Now follow this third nerve in the cavernous sinus. See, follow this third nerve in the cavernous sinus. This is the third nerve.
Yeah.
There are four nerves in the cavernous. This is the third nerve. See?
Yeah.
Going behind the carotid. Now follow this. See the third nerve.
Yeah.
This is going into the
superior orbital
fissure. So third, fourth, V1 and the sixth. See, below the anterior band of the carotid here.
Yes.
Below the anterior band. The most medial of this is the sixth nerve, abducens nerve.
Right.
This passes through this clival dura, the dural edge canal, and come along the inferior edge of the anterior genu of the carotid. This only out of these four nerves, this is the only nerve which passes through the true cavernous sinus. Rest all these three nerves lie in the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. Okay?
Yeah.
So this abducens nerve passes through the cavernous sinus and enter the orbital apex. See?
Yeah.
The nerves in the orbital apex. This is the carotid siphon. The nerve is the orbital apex and above is the carotid canal. In between was the optic strut which we have removed, and below is the optic strut separates the optic from the superior orbital fissure. And then this is the carotid siphon. Now see behind further. You see the pons. Can you see?
That's the pons, yeah.
This is the pons. This is the basilar artery which is formed below by the two vertebral arteries, two superior cerebellar arteries. These are the superior cerebellar. This is the posterior cerebral, in between is the oculomotor. Now see below and behind, in the posterior plane. See here, this is the trigeminal nerve. Oh, sorry, the trochlear nerve. In the posterior plane, suction. Below is the trigeminal. Suction. Ye lo. Chalo de do, aise hi dikhao. Give me the. Hello.
Yeah.
I am sorry. I am going very fast.
No.
If anybody has any doubts, we can discuss later. Now see the third nerve you have seen. Can you see the fourth nerve?
Yes.
Going below.
Yeah.
See below from behind.
Yeah. We can.
Third nerve comes from the ventral surface of the pons. It's seen anteriorly. See, third nerve is anterior.
Yeah.
Fourth nerve comes from the rostral surface, the dorsal surface of the pons. Lies behind. Can you see this?
Yes, we can see it emerging.
Now,
yeah.
If we remove this clivus lower down, we'll see the fifth nerve. This superior cerebellar artery. See, this is the posterior cerebral. One more important thing. This is the posterior cerebral.
Yeah.
It gives this posterior communicating. Can you see this?
Yeah, we can see.
This posterior communicating, and see where it communicates to the carotid artery.
Oh yes.
See, this is the carotid.
Yeah, fantastic.
And this is the posterior communicating branch.
Yeah.
Wow. Looks like
posterior cerebral, posterior communicating branch. It joins the carotid. That's how this basilar circulation and the carotid circulation meet and form the circle of Willis. So this is circle of Willis. The posterior communicating, the carotid artery, and the posterior cerebral, which is a branch of basilar artery. So both sides, they form the circle of Willis.
Yeah.
Now,
fantastic, Sati.
Now, if we go below, if I remove this clivus bone, see, this is the bone of the clivus. It has to be drilled. It can't be removed like this. Okay? If you go below, we'll see the fifth nerve here.
Yeah.
Fifth nerve complex. This, now see the important thing I want to show. This is the superior cerebellar artery. Can you see going down?
Yeah.
Yes.
Why does trigeminal neuralgia occurs? The vascular loop around the trigeminal nerve at the brainstem. Okay? Ashish?
Yeah.
We use the posterior fossa endoscopic approach and use a Teflon sheet
between
that vascular loop and the trigeminal nerve.
Yeah.
So that vascular loop, see this vessel going down.
Yeah.
That vascular loop is always formed by the superior cerebellar artery.
Yeah.
Which it is my here in my suction.
Okay.
So this is the superior cerebellar artery, which forms a vascular loop and gives trigeminal neuralgia almost always. Can you see the rootlets of the trigeminal nerve below?
Yeah.
In the lowermost part.
Yeah.
See that's the thickest nerve, thickest of all the nerve.
Yeah.
See this? I am trying to show.
Yeah. We can see it, Satish.
After retracting this, give me the. So this superior cerebellar artery is in close relationship to the trigeminal nerve.
The vessel enter.
Okay, now another important thing. Now see, this is the basilar artery ending into posterior cerebral arteries. What you see above? What this, you see above these two?
All the mammillary bodies.
Mammillary bodies. See now, the important thing. So this is part of the midbrain now. See, this is part of the midbrain.
Yeah.
This is pons.
Yeah.
Below, go down. So, see, behind the eustachian, the nasopharynx here would be the foramen magnum.
Yes.
So, this is pons here. The medulla oblongata will be here at the level of the floor of the sphenoid. And below is the foramen magnum. Now, see the mammillary bodies above.
Yeah.
Now, give me some angle telescope, please, fast. 30 degree. Ashish.
Yeah.
Above this mammillary bodies is the lamina terminalis, the arachnoid layer. If we open that arachnoid layer, we will be in the third ventricle. 30 degree. Give me 30 degree. Hello.
Yeah.
So let's see how the mammillary bodies has a relationship with the third ventricle. Now I'm using 30 degree, boss.
Yeah.
Do you see mammillary bodies now?
Yeah.
Clear?
Very nice.
Yeah. Now give me the some long instrument. Or yaar instrument hi nahi hai talamba.
Wrong leader, wrong leader.
Ah, ye de de, give me this scissors. Give me this scissors.
तो जरा पंच जाएगा.
See this. These. अरे यार इस डायरेक्शन नहीं है ना. See these are the mammillary bodies.
Yeah.
If I open this membrane, the Lilliput's membrane, or the lamina terminalis. See.
Oh wow. Okay.
Where I'm going? Suction.
Floor of the third ventricle.
The third ventricle. This is one of the sites where the CSF forms. See, just in brief, this third ventricle and fourth ventricle, lateral ventricles above them. Can you see the third ventricle above?
Yeah, very nicely.
And can you see some plexus?
Yes. Deep inside, yeah.
Deep inside, see this plexus, that is choroid plexus.
Oh,
and can you see the another opening above the third ventricle?
Yeah.
Above.
11 o'clock.
That is communication with the fourth ventricle.
Oh man.
So that opening is foramen of
Monroe.
The CSF is formed in the lateral ventricle, passes through the foramen Monroe, comes to the third ventricle. Here also is the choroid plexus which form the CSF, and down there see the fissure down.
Yeah.
Behind.
Yeah.
That is aqueduct of Sylvius. Through which is passes to the fourth ventricle. Okay?
Okay.
So uppermost are the lateral ventricles, both sides. Two lateral ventricles.
Yeah, see.
Two lateral ventricles, then one third ventricle, the choroid plexus, and then below is the aqueduct of Sylvius, through which is passes down to the fourth ventricle. Okay?
Fantastic. Unbelievable.
Now, lastly, hello?
Yeah.
I can't go. See, if I remove this bone down, the clivus, we'll be seeing the other cranial nerve, 6, 7th, 8, 9, 10th, 11th, and 12th here, where the hypoglossal canal is, behind the carotid artery here.
Yeah.
So like this, the third nerve, the second nerve is here, and the 12th nerve is here. So all these cranial nerves we can see, if I remove this entire bone anterior to it, see, this clivus, this floor of the sphenoid, this posterior nasopharyngeal muscles, everything, we'll see the entire brain stem.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah. Sanjay now, is saying this will be shown in Indore.
Pardon?
This, Sanjay Agarwal is saying this part in Indore.
Yeah, if you have a time, if you have a time, we can show each and every nerve their origin till final destination.
Yeah.
Now, this is the second nerve.
Yeah.
Now, anterior to this is planum sphenoidal. Okay?
Yeah.
Anterior to this, just a minute, we have seen the ethmoidal arteries. We know that this is the, what do you call that, sphenoid, or, oh sorry, the, this is the frontal sinus.
Okay.
This is the frontal sinus.
Yeah.
This is the sphenoid sinus.
Yeah.
This is the optic nerve.
Yeah.
If you remove this cribriform plate completely.
Ye tera.
From one lamina papyracea to other side lamina papyracea.
Yeah.
From the behind the frontal at the level of the
first
this thing, first olfactory neuron, this level to the sphenoid.
Yeah.
This one piece entire cribriform plate along with the upper part of the nasal septum, that is the transcribriform approach. If we remove this bone, we'll see the olfactory tract and the bulb behind it, the frontopolar arteries and the anterior cerebral arteries, which are the branch of the terminal branch of the internal carotid, the middle cerebral artery is laterally. This is transcribriform. If you go through the planum here, transplanum, we'll see this is the optic nerve. The opposite optic nerve, it joins and form the optic chiasma in between. So you can see the trans optic chiasma through the transplanum approach. Then this is through the cella. We have seen the basilar and the third ventricle above. The basilar. Now you go down through the clivus, the transclival, remove everything, the transclival approach, and you see the lower cranial nerve, the sixth nerve arising from the vertebrobasilar junction, everything. Now finally, this is the nasopharynx. See, if you remove this nasopharyngeal musculature, this is longus coli and the rectus capitis anterior muscle, you will come across the anterior longitudinal membrane, then the arch of the atlas, the first vertebra, the arch of the atlas, you drill the arch, you will come across the dens. You drill the dens, then you will come across the tectorial membrane and the dura, and behind which is the foramen magnum and the spinal cord lower down. So we can address by the endoscopic approach the lesions arising from the frontal lobe, the frontal sinus until the foramen magnum and the upper cervical vertebra, all the lesions in this plane. So these are all sagittal approaches. And lastly, for a minute, the description about the coronal approaches. Coronal approaches are devised according to the course of the carotid artery. See, this is the carotid artery here. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, in the coronal approach is basically around the carotid artery. The sagittal are in the midline. Coronal are lateral.
Okay.
So, that is again divided according to the skull base. The anterior skull base. See, the in the base of the anterior skull base, laterally, midline is the cribriform plate. Laterally is the orbit only. So are the transorbital approaches, as I told you, between the lesions inside the orbit between the inferior rectus and the medial rectus.
Yeah.
Okay. The transorbital, see, this is the inferior rectus.
Yeah.
And this is the medial rectus.
Yeah.
And see this corridor in between, the fact. Ashish,
yeah,
you have
yeah.
to go through this corridor to take biopsy in that case.
29 December.
Yeah. Now, in the coronal approach,
yeah.
for the middle skull base, that is the coronal approach. In the anterior skull base is the orbit. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, coronal approach for the middle skull base here. The main structure is the cavernous sinus. And the lateral to the cavernous sinus is the Michael's cave. So, to approach the cavernous sinus and the Michael's cave, you follow the V2. See, this is the V2.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You V2, this is the carotid artery.
Yeah.
Above is the abducens now, and below is the horizontal carotid. This quadrangular area between all these four structures, this is the safest zone. If you go through this, you will be directly onto the cavernous sinus and the Michael's cave laterally. Okay?
Okay.
Secondly, see, this is the carotid artery. See?
Yeah.
If I retract this carotid artery at the level of the sphenoid sinus laterally, here, huh?
Yeah.
This bone, I can feel this bone, is the petrous apex.
Oh, okay.
So like petrous apex, cholestatoma,
yeah.
cholesterol granuloma, you just drill around the carotid, skeletonize it, lateralize it from the sphenoid, and you can easily drain the cholesterol granuloma,
yes.
all these structures from the sphenoid sinus. So that is medial to it.
Yeah.
One is lateral to it, the quadrangular space. Then through the infratemporal fossa, through the hypoglossal canal, there are many approaches. Okay?
Okay.
So those are the coronal approaches.
Yeah.
I don't think we'll be able to do all these approaches right now because of the time constraint.
No, 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 okay.
But this was a brief description of the skull-based surgery and the anatomy.
Okay.
All these things, the
fantastic,
basic thing is the anatomy.
Satish. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
Super, Satish.
Thank
brilliant.
You, boss. Thank
brilliant.
You so much.
You heard the applause.
Unbelievable. Okay.
Hello?
Great.
Hello?
Yeah, yeah, Satish.
Are you still seeing?
Yes, we are seeing.
See,
what is that?
What I was doing?
Yeah.
Retracting the orbit.
Yeah.
And see the anterior ethmoidal artery.
Ah, okay.
Leaving the orbit.
Fantastic.
See the frontal sinus?
Yeah.
Where it is leaving the orbit?
Yeah.
At the fronto, this is the frontal, this is the ethmoidal bone.
Yeah, wo bone
into this canal at the fronto ethmoidal junction.
Ah.
See, this is the anterior ethmoid. Similarly,
go
behind,
bone
you'll see the posterior ethmoid. Here is the posterior ethmoid. Thank you so much.
Show that we are there. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, hey, posterior ethmoid, dekha.
Demonstration. And
okay.
Dr. Satish Jain from a bottom-up heart. Thank you, sir.
Galgali.
Dr. Galgali, thanks. All thanks to you, sir, for organizing and...
Mind-blowing, man. Absolutely mind-blowing.
Thank you, sir.
Funny, sir.
ये मेरे को बोलता है
एक्सीलेंट सर
थैंक यू
आई विश नोबडी हैज टू गो आउटसाइड दिस रिक्वायर्स आवर्स एंड आवर्स
ऑफ कोर्स
टू डू ऑल दिस डिसेक्शन ना दिस रिक्वायर्स मोर देन 12 आवर्स अब ये फ्रेश नहीं होता ना गौरी कुछ नहीं दिखा रहा कल बुरा तो लग रहा होगा कि मैं जिद कर रहा हूँ बट पीपल विल नॉट बी हैप्पी विदाउट द फ्रेश in the dry caravan you couldn't see anything.
You can't make out all the
मैंने तो कल यही कहा उसको बहुत सारे ड्राई रखा तो आना ही बेकार है पब्लिक को मजा ही नहीं आता अब पब्लिक को मजा आया ना तो दिक्कत तो हुई मेरी वजह से मैंने बोला कि फ्रेश ही होना चाहिए लेकिन इट्स यूजलेस टू डू विदाउट अ फ्रेश कलर
ऑडियो विजुअल